Good evening, everyone. Can I please have a motion and a second to reconvene the public meeting?
Motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Can we please all stand for the Pledge of Allegiance, followed by a moment of silence to honor our servicemen and women? Thank you. Will the district clerk please call the roll?
Mrs. Iannatelli?
Present.
Mrs. DiLorenzo? Mrs. DiLorenzo? Oh, I'm sorry.
Present.
Thank you. Mrs. Napolitano Perna?
Present.
Dr. Centermore?
Present.
Mrs. Mallon?
Present.
Mr. Murphy?
Present.
Mr. Colley-Keefer?
Here.
Mrs. Pappy?
Present.
And Mr. Hauser?
Present.
Thank you. Can I please have a motion and a second to accept the minutes of the January 9, 2024 meeting?
Motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. All right, now the fun. Today is a special day. We have a lot of people in the audience. I'm going to let Dr. Centermore take over from here.
Thank you very much. And I am ecstatic tonight because we have many, 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 many dozens of our high school students in attendance tonight. And I just want everybody to think for a moment about what we're acknowledging that they've accomplished. We're talking about students who earned a perfect score on a New York State Regents examination and/or an AP examination. Some of our students, those overachievers, did it on a few exams. I am floored. We have over 100. I couldn't be more proud. And I do understand I inherited this highly talented group, all of our kids, 5,300 strong, as we're acknowledging these achievements from June. This is incredible. This is a beautiful tradition that was started by Dr. Adams, my predecessor. Very proud that the Board of Education, felt very strongly that we continue with. This is our bread and butter. Tonight is a big night because we're acknowledging our students and their accomplishments, and we're also taking a deep dive into our, at the secondary level, especially into our academics. But this is part, a big part of the end game, where we just don't focus on basic level learning. We focus on that deep understanding and that mastery. And when you earn, our students, when you earn perfect score on one of these type of examinations, that is significant. That is reason to shout, which sometimes I get a little loud about these things. Very, very proud, very excited. If you can't tell, I'll try to be a little bit more enthusiastic as the ceremony goes on. But I'm going to take this very proud baton, pass it to Ms. Poppy and our directors so we can start to acknowledge all of our brilliant young people tonight. Thank you.
So, Dr. Centermore, I'm going to ask you to join me, and we're going to be handing out some certificates off of this stage. And why don't we get started with our certificates for perfect scores on our FLACS exams with Mrs. Cheryl Sosa, our Director of World Language and ENL.
Buenas tardes. Daniel Esquivias. Michael Fabry, Caitlin Flynn, James Chen. Are we here?
Come on down. Come on down.
Sophia Carrera. Sophia. Mia Garcia. Crystal Ruiz Otero. Leah DeRosa. Juan Carlos Alvarez. Madison Holtzmacher, Sarah Marinelli, Dylan Lopez, David Hernandez, Ella Fien, Javier Vargas, Avery Getty, Keegan Gripa, Sophie Jamrozek, Sophia Lum. Paul Hine, Natalie Insiga, Nell Lesiak, Rafael Garcia, Stephanie Laughlin, Caitlin Stephenson, Isabella Molinaro, Emma Catalano, Sofia Bonetta, Nathaniel Johnson, Manfia, Koyesh, Emma Marchetti, Minal Ahmed, Yomar Rodriguez Torres, Massimiliano Lopez, Nicholas Paravalos, Jacob Berkeley, Luis Rodriguez, Daniel Del Cid. Daniel Del Cid, yes, I'm sorry. Gabriela Castillo Rodriguez, Haley Sisk, Lily Dreidopel, Sheila Shimbai Monge, Isabella Salazar Herrera, Alec Robao, Catherine Poli, Laura Lobos Marin, Giselle Reyes Campos, Kyle Callahan, Abrahim Afghani, and Julia Ferraioli. Congratulations, guys. Wonderful job.
Now we have our...
I'm sorry?
Now we have our...
Yes. It was weird at first. People like...
What a group. Next, I'd like to invite Mr. Robert Kassane to the podium to present our perfect scores in social studies and in AP level social studies courses.
Thank you, Ms. Poppy. I'll start with the Global History 100 on the Regents exam. Anthony Gulo. Olivia Oxlin, Lindsay Quinn, Samir Umar, Preston Heaney, Brady Luca, James Chen, Addison Devery, Alexander DeVita, Valentina Gutierrez, Martina Miletti, Thomas Mills, Michael Patanjo, Severino Roderick, Gianna Stecker, John Thelen, Kevin Unterweiser, and now to the U.S. History Regents 100s, Varshith Bessa, Adam Dabrowski, Corey DeCristofaro, Ryan Hamayoun, Aiden Lyon, Nadia Marcelino, Andrew Mullane, and Brandon Ziegler. All right, and I'm going to transition to the AP exams. Starting with Modern World History, Arman Singh, Valentina Gutierrez, Hajra Ahmed, Minal Ahmed, Tasnuva Kayesh, Leah DeRosa, Bethany Ugenti. Thomas Mills. Gianna Mealy. Joseph Scarabino. Rubama Hossein. Madeline Messner. Michael Chalmers. Addison Devery. Emily Pascarello. Michael Patanjo. James Chen. Martina Maletti. Zara Afghani. For AP US History, Nadia Marcelino. Nadia. Ashley Mers. Nicole Kurzrock. Cheyenne Ahmed. Victoria Otero. Andrew Murata. Vincent Maraviglia. Alyssa Feldman. Emily Musa. Corey DeCristofaro. Nicholas Murata. Nicholas Murata. Kieran Fisher. Victoria Douglas. Kaden Reiger. Cadence Brown. Adam Dabrowski. And now for AP Psychology, Frank Viola. Cheyenne Ahmed. Andrew Murata. Mia Lang. Katie Haynes. Devin Elster. Rhea Shetty. Daniel Avila. Emily Musa. Cameron Angelo. Nicholas Murata. Daniela O'Neill. And finally, for AP European History, Arman Singh. Alexander DeVita. And Corey DeCristofaro.
Can you hear me now?
Here we go. I'd like to invite Mrs. Stephanie Burns to the podium, our Director for Science, Family and Consumer Sciences, and Technology Education, to present some recognitions in science.
All right, first up, near and dear to my heart as a former earth science teacher, Sophie Jamrozek got 100 on the earth science region. On the living environment regents with a perfect score, Kevin Unterweiser. On the living environment regents and also on the AP biology exam, perfect scores for Declan Duran. On the chemistry regents, Michael Patano. A perfect score on the chemistry regents for Alexander DeVita. Also, perfect score on the chemistry regents for Thomas Mills. And fives on the AP biology exam for Tessa Dollinger. A five on the AP bio exam for Michael Fabry. A five on the AP biology exam for Madison Holzmacher. Madison. And a five on the AP Physics 1 exam for Cheyenne Ahmed. Congratulations, everyone.
Mrs. Louise Berger will join us at the podium now to present some recognitions in mathematics and computer science.
Thank you, Ms. Poppy. I'd like to call up two of the teachers that contributed to the student success. We have Ms. Mary Beth Keenan from Oakdale Bohemia Middle School, Algebra 1 teacher, and Ms. Christine Caputo, Algebra 2 teacher from Connecticut High School. Okay, first up for Algebra 1 region's perfect score, Tiffany Wang. Algebra 1 region's again, Danielle Delsid. Kyle Callahan. Elena Chaccio. Kimberly Greenwood. Matthew Coster. Moving on to Algebra 2, perfect score on the Algebra 2 regents, Thomas Mills and Alexandra DeVita. Alexander DeVita. Moving along to AP Computer Science Principals, Ryan Beatty, James Chen, Katarina Pompadon, Krish Patel. Congratulations again to all of you.
Mr. Vincent Malafronte, please report to the podium to deliver some good news about our AP Music program.
So receiving a perfect score on the AP Music exam last year, we have Alyssa Feldman. That's it. Oh, they go all the way up around. Stay right there. Take the pick right there.
And finally, Mrs. Danielle Matina, who is going to present some recognitions in English language arts.
Good evening, everyone. I would like to start with the ELA Regents' perfect score, Shannon Brett. Corey DiCristofaro. Madeline Rosato. Matthew Methvin. Andrew Rakowski. Isabella Kaspiv. Edward Fogarty. Rachel Johnson. Michael Kerr. Sienna Perez. Victoria Otero. Haley Ekisabal. Olivia Coffill. And finally, for a perfect score of 5 on the AP English Language and Composition exam, Cheyenne Ahmed, Daniel Avila, Gregory Baldinucci, Victoria Douglas, Madison Fiorini, Katie Haynes, Andrew Mullane, Daniela O'Neill, and Andrew Rakowski. Congratulations, everyone.
Congratulations, everyone. That's amazing. I know you guys got to go home and study for midterms.
Say something, Sophie. Do it now.
All right, so that was an amazing accomplishment by our students. Congratulations to everyone again. I am going to pass the mic again to Dr. Sensimore, who is going to speak on two of our amazing club advisors.
So we were also hoping tonight to acknowledge, in addition to our brilliant students, who, by the way, I hope by shaking your hand via osmosis, some of that brilliance might have carried over into me. Was so very proud of our students. And we also have to give a lot of credit, in addition to their parents and families, to the staff that work with them. We have a lot of staff in attendance tonight, teachers, directors, principals, and we thank them so much. But tonight we were also hoping to acknowledge a couple of our advisors who have done a lot of have a good night, sir, who have done really a great job with one of our outstanding programs over at our excellent high school in terms of our freshman awareness program. And so we just want to give a shout out to both of our advisors, who I don't think they were able to make it here tonight, but we'll be sure to send their certificates over to them. We have them right here, some beautiful certificates for Ms. Goodwin and for Ms. Semp, just to acknowledge all the great work that they've done for freshman awareness. I was able to speak earlier this year about my own. It was my first, you know, I'm a freshman here in rookie freshman here in Connecticut, and I got to attend the event, and I thought it was tremendous. As an adult educator, it was impactful to me, and I felt like it was, to our ninth grade students as well. Appreciate, the administration and the staff at the high school who were an active part in support of our advisors, and a shout out to both of them and the great work that they did for freshman awareness. Looking forward to next year as well.
Yay. Thank you so much, Dr. Sennemore. I will now pass the baton to Mr. Hauser, who will do a presentation on our fiscal stress, tax cap, and reserves.
Thank you. Okay, good evening. This is our second presentation of the budget, the proposed budget for the 2024-25 school year. And tonight we're going to speak about, speak about four topics. Number one is something called fiscal stress. The second topic will be state aid. The third topic will be the tax cap. And the fourth topic will be the district's reserves. And this presentation is on the district's website. So if anyone is having a tough time seeing or being able to read the slides, you can see it on the website as well. So here's the calendar as we move forward into the budget season here. I highlighted in yellow where we are today with the presentation. And then the next presentation will be on February 13th, where we'll speak about staffing programs and enrollment. So fiscal stress. The state comptroller's office a while back started monitoring school districts in terms of their fiscal stability. And I'm proud to say that the most recent report from the Comptroller's Office shows the Connectquot School District, for the most part, with zero fiscal stress. This slide that I put up here, it just shows how the Comptroller's Office is looking at five components. Number one, they're looking at a district's unassigned fund balance, the year-end fund balance, whether the school district has had any operating deficits, which we have not, the current cash position or the cash on hand, and then our reliance on short-term debt for cash flow. So like I said, they have four designations. I'll say the most serious is if they give you a significant designation, and then moderate would be the second. The third designation would be you're susceptible to fiscal stress. And then the fourth one is no designation. So that's the category we fall in there. Here, I know this is very difficult to read. It's very fine print, but this is the actual fiscal stress report. It's available, like I said, on the website. It's also available up at the Comptroller's Office as well. And it pretty much says the same thing that I just mentioned in the last slide. It just goes into a little more detail here. Okay, the next topic, state aid. So last week, the governor issued what's called the executive budget proposal. And as part of that, the governor told each school district in New York State what their proposed state aid is going to be for the next school year. There are one, two, three, really four parts to this slide. The far left shows the state aid we are currently receiving this school year. So all the way down to the bottom is a total of $55,259,485. And that's made up, I think, of 11 different components of state aid. The second column is the governor's actual initial proposal for our state aid, and that totals just over $55,006,027. Unfortunately, that's a decrease in state aid of $253,458. Or just a little bit below 0.5%. So that's not the news we were looking for. The main component here, and I don't want to get too deep into this, is something called Hold Harmless. And it focuses on that top piece of aid there that we all tend to hear about over and over again, which is foundation aid. Districts that were subject to receiving a decrease in foundation aid over the last few years were placed in what they call a hold harmless situation, where you were guaranteed a 3% increase. So we have been receiving that 3% increase. Unfortunately, right now, up at the governor's office, she has decided to remove that hold harmless provision. Well, it remains to be seen whether that holds up or not, but because of that, we're actually in a negative situation here with state aid.
Mr. Hauser, I'm going to chime in for a second on this point. Myself and several members of our board recently attended an advocacy workshop, and this was a key theme. And so I'm currently drafting an advocacy letter that will be vetted through the board, that will also be copied to our local state level senators and assembly people, advocating for, at a minimum, what Mr. Hauser was referring to in terms of that hold harmless, state aid increase, which is modest, as opposed to what is initially being proposed by the governor as a cut, as a decrease. Now, for those of you who may have followed the state-level budgeting process in recent years, you might know that in New York State, oftentimes things get legislated through the budgeting process. So oftentimes these early proposed state aid runs for school districts, they get leveraged in negotiations up in Albany. And then at the end of the day, when the final runs come out, you know, districts hopefully do a little bit better. However, advocacy is a key thing because if we're not heard, then we may be forgotten. So, you know, I want to assure our community that, one, this is an initial proposal by the governor, not the final aid, and that, two, myself in my capacity as superintendent of schools and your Board of Education, we are actively advocating, again, working through all locally represented state-level senators and assembly people. And this same advocacy is happening across Long Island, if not the entire state, because many, many school districts have been impacted, at least by these initial proposals. Thank you, Mr. Hauser.
You're welcome. So just to finish up on this slide, the far right side, I have a column there with the word if the 3% hold harmless were to be placed back into the governor's budget. And as you can see down at the bottom, that would bring us to a total of $56,500,000, which would be a little over $1.2 million increase in state aid, or 2.25%. So big difference. We have about 70 days to go. March 31st is when the legislature up in Albany is supposed to agree on a final budget. The state itself starts their new year, April 1st. So they typically tell school districts just before then what their final state aid numbers are going to be. So for now, we have to go with what the governor is telling us, but hopefully things change and we can see a more positive number. Okay, the third part of the presentation is called the tax cap. So for most of us, we commonly hear the 2% tax cap that's been in effect now well over 10 years. And it's made up of two components. One of them up at the top is called tax base growth factor. And for the most part, the state assigns, the Office of Real Property assigns a number to each district that reflects or is supposed to reflect the change in assessed valuations in a school district. So what they're trying to do with this number is if homes or new homes are built in a school district, they're supposed to allow your tax cap some flexibility to grow to accommodate that growth in possible student population. As you can see there, or I'll just read it so if you can, 1.0046 is our number, just shy of a half a percent they're allowing for us there. And then the next number is what's called the allowable levy growth factor. That's typically tied to the consumer price index. That's the number that cannot exceed 2%. So we all know for the most part in our own personal experiences that inflation has gone up more than 2%. But unfortunately, with the tax cap, school districts are capped for the following year at 2%. So if you add those two numbers together, you should come up with 2.46. And I'm just going to expand on that. So roughly 2.5% is the amount we're allowed to collect next year from the resident and the commercial taxpayers in the district. Okay, so there's a formula here that the comptroller's office makes us go through to figure out exactly how much we can collect. I don't want to bore you with this math, but starts off with what we're collecting right now, which is $139,188,000 from the tax base. And if you follow that number all the way down, the tax cap says we are allowed to collect $142,608,000, which is just shy of a $3.5 million increase, or right back to that 2.45, 2.46 number. So that's our cap that we have to work with. I highlighted it up at the top that this is a projection. There are several factors, mainly exemptions, that go into this number that we are working on right now. So it's possible this number of 2.45 could increase, but like everything else, it's also possible that it could go down. So hopefully we'll be able to finalize that number shortly. And coming into the home stretch. So just to piggyback off of our fiscal stress score, which was a very positive score, this slide here focuses on our reserves and also our fund balance. So the far left column tells you what we had back in June of 2022, literally in our bank accounts. We have several different reserves that are all listed on the left, from workers' comp to unemployment, employee retirement system, and so on down the line. So back in 2022, we had a little over $45 million in reserves and fund balance. Fast forward 1 year to this past June, if you go all the way down to the bottom, we had $45,415,000. So about just under $500,000 decrease there. And then the third column is how much of those reserves we are using to actually fund, I'll use the word subsidize as well, the current budget. So for example, in that workers' compensation reserve of $6 million, we went into that reserve and we pulled out $1.6 million to fund our workers' compensation expense. We happen to be self-insured for workers' comp. So if someone gets hurt on the job, we have to pay dollar for dollar, whatever the claim may be. And then the far right column there is what our projected fund balance is going to be at the end of this school year. If you take that all the way down to the bottom, we come up with $33,930,000. That's what we project. Typically, once the books are closed for the school year, usually in August or September, we try to replenish those reserves. So I'm optimistic that once the school year is finished and the books are closed, that we will hopefully be able to replenish these reserves back up to where they were last year in the $45 million range. And that's it. Any questions, comments?
So we most definitely need to advocate this year, like Dr. Sentimore said. When we were at this on Saturday, when we went to the, which was a wonderful forum, we learned a lot. And it really did explain to us that now that there's so many cuts in aid, we just can't make it up in aid with the 2% tax cap, trying to do it through local funding. So what I had noticed, and I wonder if we can keep an eye on, is they're looking at ways to modify it and establish an exclusion for school safety expenditures. They actually said that they were recommending excluding certain school security expenses from the cap to ensure safe learning environments. If that goes through under the 10 legislative changes for school success, that could be huge for us because it could make available a lot more of the funding to keep us under that tax cap. Because we really need to make sure that we stay under it, because we can't be, I'll never support piercing the cap, as you know. And I got to tell you, this year, we really got to keep an eye on what we're doing funding-wise, considering, as I've said, the last 10 years enrollment's gone down and a lot of other things have not.
Anybody else have any questions for Mr. Hauser? Thank you so much. I will now hand the meeting over to Ms. Poppy, who will have an academic presentation for the secondary level.
I'm just going to transfer the clicker. Good evening, everyone. I am so very proud to be able to present or lead a presentation along with our incredible administrators who are here this evening regarding our secondary curriculum. I think that this presentation, which is a true collaboration amongst our principals and our district-wide directors, I think it will give you a fantastic idea of our highlights, of where we're going programmatically, of the opportunities that we offer in both of our middle schools and our high school. And I'm really looking forward to kind of just allowing their voices to fill the room. So my leadership in this meeting is going to be minimal. They're really narrating the presentation. And just for the sake of facility, I'm going to introduce them at the forefront of the presentation, say a little something, and then we'll kind of get underway. So I'm pleased to have here tonight Mr. Michael Moran, the principal of Connecticut High School, Mr. Joseph Licato, the principal of Ronkonkoma Middle School, Mr. Joseph Piombo, the principal of Oakdale Bohemia Middle School, who unfortunately fell ill today and isn't able to join us this evening, Mrs. Jessica Yoni Kohler, our director of guidance, Mrs. Cheryl Sosa, our district-wide director of world languages and ENL, Mr. Robert Cassine, our director of social studies and business, Mrs. Stephanie Burns, our director of science, family and computer sciences and technology education, family and consumer sciences and technology education, Mr. Peter Mallory, director of health, physical education and recreation, Mrs. Louise Berger, our director of mathematics and computer science, Mr. Vincent Malafronte, our director of fine arts and music education, and Ms. Danielle Matina, our director of English language arts and library. So to start this evening's overview, I just wanted to mention the systemic collaboration that happens on a daily basis here in Connecticut. No one program, no one initiative, no one opportunity is the result of one person's work. It's really a brain trust, if you will, of the minds in this room, along with our faculty and, of course, our student input as well, to help move systems forward. One item that I did want to mention before we kind of get underway here is that all of our curriculum is really locally developed. Those decisions are made around the table in Connecticut for Connecticut students. The state in recent years has moved away fully from what we all remember as the Common Core learning standards. We've taken a step in order to personalize those standards into the next generation learning standards that bridge every curriculum area that you're going to hear from this evening. And so we're united in terms of the guidelines that the state sets for us instructionally and academically, the expectations that we have for students that align with their performance and their graduation responsibilities. But the local pieces are what really make us shine and what I hope you gain from tonight's presentation. So without further ado, Mr. Moran's going to talk to us a little bit about Connecticut High School's most recent performance and some of the highlights there. And from there, it will be a kind of a continual presentation from every building and subject area. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Poppy, and thank you for having us here tonight. Connecticut High School right now has a 99% graduation rate. 98% of those students receive a Regents diploma, 70% receive a Regents with advanced designation, and 30% earn a Regents diploma with advanced designation with honors, meaning that the students get 90 or higher on all their Regents exams. So 30%, that's great. 112 of our students earn the seal of civic readiness through our social studies department. 96 students earn the seal of biliteracy through our world language department. And right now, we currently have 9 subject honor society that we honor. So 9 different subjects, we have an honor society. And 44 students graduated last year with a technical endorsement. Most of them received that through BOCES. Awesome. 463 students sat for 987 AP exams. 97 students were named advanced placement scholars, meaning they got 3 or higher on 3 or more exams. 34 of those students were AP scholars with honors, meaning those students had an average of 3.25 on all AP exams taken and a 3 or higher on 4 or more exams. And we even had 50 AP scholars with distinction, meaning they averaged 3.5 on all the AP exams the students took with a 3 or higher on 5 exams. 12 of our students are an AP Capstone Diploma, which is a 2-year program through our Social Studies and English departments. 7 students earned an AP Seminar and Research Certificate through our Science and English departments. And 30 dual enrollment courses are currently available for a possible of 106 college credits. That starts in 10th grade. And our third-party ratings right now, the NEESH rating in 2024 was 320. U.S. News and World Report in 2023-24 was 244 in New York State. And obviously, school data can change and numbers fluctuate from year to year. Okay.
Sorry, can we ask questions like throughout? I just want, can you elaborate a little more, Mr. Moran, on the Capstone Diploma? Just for people that are not aware.
There are courses through English and Social Studies. Ms. Moynihan teaches and Mr. Gillum teaches courses at the high school. It's a 2-year program that the students have to complete completely to have that distinction on their diploma. So,
thank you.
There are also different levels of capstone achievement, and that Mr. Moran referenced that in the slide just below that capstone level. So the capstone is the highest level of achievement. But students who are enrolled in seminar and research, those 2 courses that Mr. Moran referenced, can also earn certificates. So the College Board has given them sort of multiple opportunities to show off in terms of their learning through those 2 courses. So it's a connection of seminar and research and student performance in both of those courses for the capstone, or they can earn some recognition for each course individually, seminar and research.
Thank you.
Research are 2 different classes?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Moran.
I can't sit still. My name is Joe Licato, for those of you who don't know me. And I want to welcome everybody around Concomo Middle School, my home away from home. Thank you so much for having me. Santo said that I can move around, and hello to everybody at home. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the middle schools, the wonder years, I'm going to call them, okay? Very challenging. I know Mr. Moran went over a lot of data with you, and although we don't have those kind of stakes here in the middle school, this is what we are preparing students for. When they come to us from in 5th grade. And there is a lot of, yes, I did. I'm not used to a clicker either, so you have to excuse me, okay. So they come to us from 5th grade, the elementary schools, and all different levels of readiness, maturity, anxiety. Some students adjust very quickly. Some not so much. But when they do come to us, you know, rest assured that both middle schools, and I want to speak for my counterpart at the other end, Joe Piombo, we have transitioned for the students basically 3 times. At the end of the year in June, well, they're 5th graders, they come up here and they get a chance to meet all of us and this room, they meet 6th grade students who walk them around the building. They get an opportunity to talk to and meet all of their teachers. And it's their first, you know, dip into the pool of a larger building. And I think their greatest fear is that going from the nurturing one classroom pretty much environment of an elementary school, now they have 9 periods throughout the day. And I think the lockers scare them the most. So we do a lot of preparation with them. We try to relieve their anxiety. It's basically a 3-prong approach that we have for this transition. The second, which is probably even more important, is for the parents. Parents, we have a parent orientation night, both schools do, where we talk to the parents about what a student's schedule looks like, what their daily routine will look like. They get a chance to meet us in the auditorium, the administration, the guidance counselors. We talk about all of the support that we have in place for them. And then finally, at the end of the summer, when the students, the sixth graders, get their schedules, they get an opportunity to come here. They're able to walk through the building to their classrooms, their schedules. We meet in here as a new family, and they get a chance to meet the teachers, and they go through the building. And like I said, they spend most of the time trying to spin the lock, which is very important to them. However, that's just before they get into school. When they do come here, you know, our sixth grade teachers, and I'm hoping, I know one of them is watching us, watching this at home, doesn't miss a board meeting. But our sixth grade teachers, I have to say, have one of the most challenging jobs. And the reason it's one of the most challenging jobs is because by the time student gets to eighth grade, they're acclimated here. A sixth grade teacher has to try to nurture, but also get students academically ready, organized, get them ready from going from class to class. And like I said, it all different levels. But I'm going to use Mrs. Poppy's term. I think I advanced this one. I shouldn't. Systemic collaboration. That's Mrs. Poppy's term that I ripped off. Okay. But we use our student support staff. Our student support staff are our counselors, our social worker, our school psychologists, as I said, all of our teaching staff. And I got to tell you, we have the greatest secretaries in the world in this building. They make everybody, including new students, feel comfortable. We use all of our people to try to help this transition from elementary school better. It's a great big world over here in this building to them. And as I said, some kids, it takes a good part of the year to get used to it, you know? But it is amazing to see the growth from sixth grade to eighth grade. That's one part of our job. Also, I even have our academic directors, who are sitting around right here now. Our academic directors. We are in constant collaboration and communication with one another. Also, as being a principal around Concord Middle School, I frequently call the other end of town. We talk about topics that come up, social trends, things that may be dangerous for students. We discuss these things. Are you seeing this here? I'm having a situation here. So, you know, we are a family, and I've been here a pretty long time, 23 years. And like I say, I have a lot of friends that I've worked with. I've worked with Mike Moran in the high school for many years. So we do communicate, and we do talk, and we do that for the benefit of the students. One of the exciting things that we had this year for sixth grade students was a change in our academic program. Change of an academic program, we introduced a flex program, which is a dip into foreign language, which I think is, well, first of all, it's only halfway through the year. But if I had to assess how it was going now, I have to say, I think it's one of the greatest additions that we have. Students get a chance to, sixth graders get a chance to try out French. They get a chance to try out Italian. We don't have it yet in Spanish. Perhaps we'll add that in the future, but right now it's an opportunity for students to learn a little bit about French, a little bit about Italian, and as they move on, they get the opportunity in seventh grade to choose a language of their preference. Also, we added writing. As an English teacher at heart, I have to say writing is one of the most challenging and one of the most, I think, important skills that all of us have to have. And I'm very excited about it this year. We do follow a writing program that I believe was put into place, I would say, about 4 years or 5 years ago. And it is a continuum from sixth, seventh, and eighth grade, this program that we do use. So I think it's been very successful. I look forward to assessing it at the end of the year, see how things go. And we added digital literacy also this year as, I don't want to call it an elective, but as something that all students are able to take. Okay? All right, now how do I do this? Here we go. As I said, our whole goal is to recognize the end game, those great scores that Mr. Moran talked about. We try to increase the rigor from year to year. So as a student goes from sixth to eighth grade, okay, we level up our instruction. There's enrichment. There's opportunity for enrichment. Students are able to, in eighth grade, take STEM classes that focus on mathematics and science. Students are also able to take communication classes. Unfortunately, we don't really have the opportunity for electives in the middle school, but this is a small piece of that. In seventh grade, they also can take computer essentials. And I know I don't have to tell anybody here or at home what a rich music and arts program we have here. It was one of the things that attracted me to Connecticut when I first came here. Students have an opportunity to participate in a lot of our music programs. So that also is great. We have, and I'm sure the directors are going to probably talk a little bit about this, we do use two, I want to say, assessment and or screening programs. One is called iReady, and that's ELA-based, and the other one is called the MSDA Math Screener. I think they're given, well, I know they're given three times a year, and what they do is basically assess the level the students are at and to measure growth. It also gives us data to see what we need to improve on, what instruction maybe students aren't getting. So it seems to be, and it has been, a very useful tool. In addition, during the scheduling process that we're beginning now, and I'm sure Mrs. Yoni Cole is going to talk about that, our eighth grade students, each and every one of them meet with their guidance counselors. They do have an opportunity to choose electives for the high school. I know you had that great fair at the high school that explained some of those to the kids. But also, like I said, our guidance counselors do go over what electives are available for them. Our teachers put in course recommendations right about now. And we also do that for our sixth and seventh grade students. Every student is met by his or her guidance counselor. So like I said, I know we are just the middle years or the wonder years, but I feel like we do a nice job contributing to that success at the high school. So thank you, and I appreciate it. I appreciate everything that everybody does here for us. Any questions?
Well, RMS is very lucky to have you.
Well, thank you.
We are very lucky to have you as a parent of RMS. You are not just a fantastic principal, but you are a fantastic addition to the music department. Because for those who don't know, Mr. Licato is an amazing singer. And when him and the teachers get on stage, they do a dynamite show with the kids.
Don't get nervous. I didn't pick this up because I was going to do anything. But no, I'm kidding. But that will thank you. I appreciate it.
You really go above and beyond, and we appreciate it in the community.
I do have to say it's a pleasure to work also with Mr. Piombo in the other building. We talk quite a bit. Some great things happen at OBMS, you know, as they do here. But I really, really do enjoy collaborating with the other building. And, you know, I did talk to him today, and he really was very, very ill. But I'm sure we're going to catch up tomorrow. Okay.
Any discussions of you guys going to be chefs this year? I know Mr. Piombo did it.
I'm gonna be the chef of the future. You know what I'm talking about? chef of the future. Like Ralph Graham did.
I love seeing the celebrity chefs. Yeah. And
I would love to do that. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jessie Yoni Kohler. I'm the director of guidance, and I'm not going to lie. If he started singing, I was going home because I was not going to follow that act. All right. So I am here to talk about the guidance and counseling program that in our secondary schools. to start with our middle school program, we, you know, what was touched on already is that really where the counselors shine is in the transition for our students. We're helping them come in as elementary students, adjusting to a bigger school, more movement, more classes, more teachers, and supporting that shift from an elementary model to that more independent middle school model. And then we really do hone in on that 8th to 9th grade transition, in which the students are preparing for the next level of their school career. And a big piece of that is the academic choice. So helping students and guiding them in choosing those electives, making sure that they're setting themselves on a path for not only success, but to explore all the options that we have for them so that they are making the most of what time they have here with us in ConnectQuad so that they are prepared for what comes after. Because while they're in middle school, in that 8th grade year, we are already starting to think about where are we going after ConnectQuad. It seems pretty fast because they are still young in the 8th grade year, but it comes around very quickly. So our counselors are very adept in helping them in make that transition. We are getting ready to do our 8th grade scheduling assemblies, actually. I'll be coming down and facilitating with the counselors in supporting our students in getting them ready to select those elective courses. So that's a major part of and component of their job. And then also we talk about career exploration in the middle years. We do have a Naviance program that is touched on in both buildings in different courses, and the counselors do help facilitate that. The counselors in each building run and facilitate some phenomenal career fair opportunities for our students. The 8th grade has a career day each spring, and that is a full hands-on-deck opportunity for our students. We bring in dozens and dozens of guest speakers. We have some board members that have participated in the past. We're very grateful for that. And it is a really nice kickoff to the idea of future planning for our students, and especially helps them get excited for that high school experience. We also do, through the guidance office, facilitate the Boy Scouts of America program, in which we bring in guest speakers to the different grade levels. RMS does it in one grade level, I think it's 8th grade, and OBMS does it in 7th grade, and they push into classes with guest speakers, again, to just increase that exposure for our students with the idea that careers are out there in all different fields. The possibilities are endless, and it's the idea that if they are exposed to it, then they're going to ask questions, and then that could lead them down a path that they never expected before. So that's where our counselors really do shine. In the middle level, we really do see a focus on social and emotional and academic counseling. So they're coming in young, they're coming in needing a lot of support, maybe some hand-holding, some coddling. So the counselors do provide that, helping them to learn to navigate different social situations. We have students coming from one building where they've been together for a very long time, and then all of a sudden we have large mixes coming together and navigating all of those new friendships and the growing pains that can come along with that and be associated with it. So that's where the counseling staff really does spend the majority of their time at the middle years, in supporting that personal growth. But they are also offering academic supports in checking in with students to make sure they're making that adequate academic progress through the 3 years that they are at a level to be successful in high school. And we accomplish this through group counseling, individual counseling, and then they are part of our crisis management team at each building. And then moving on to the high school program, the high school program has a slightly different feel than the middle school program, where we do see a lot of the social and emotional counseling that happens at the middle school level. There is some of that happens at the high school, but it is much more of an academic and post-high school planning drive that we see at the high school level. So we do start off with our 8th to 9th grade transition supports, but then we also talk about our post-high school transition support. And that really does start kind of as soon as they come in the door, where we are thinking, what's the plan after this, and how do we get you to that point on time? Because we have 4 years to get them all of the requirements as laid out by New York State to get them to graduate. But that comes around, again, very quickly. So what will be the plan once that end does come? We accomplish this with every 5 weeks. Our counselors are reviewing the academic progress of their students. Our counselors meet with students regularly in terms of attendance, grades, growth, all those different things that we're seeing. And then also a big piece of that, as I mentioned, is the graduation tracking, because we are held very firm by New York State standard as to what our students must accomplish in order to, for us as at ConnectQuad to confer them at graduates at the end of those 4 years. We see the scheduling piece as a main function of the job, because what we take from the students is how we build the master schedule. There are innumerable courses that we offer at ConnectQuad, and so many choices for our students to take part in. And the counselors are crucial in helping to guide students on those choices to make sure that they are selecting things that are meaningful in their projection towards career and college or trade, but also to make sure that we are getting the best data that we can to make the best master schedule for the building to run efficiently. We do also oversee the BOCES scheduling program, and that is our career and technical training relationship that we have. So we are currently this year sending 144 students to half-day vocational training programs from ConnectQuad High School, and our students participate in, have the eligibility to participate in all 28 programs as offered by BOCES. And I do want to thank the board and ConnectQuad for that, because that is unique to ConnectQuad in that we do not limit our students in certain choices of programs. So we do support our students in exploring BOCES through info sessions that happen in the building, field trips that we can take them to visit BOCES, and then helping them with the scheduling, because they do miss half of their day to go to that program. So we ensure that our students have that opportunity for success. And then the largest piece that I would say of the counseling, the high school counseling program, is this idea of college and career counseling. So these are some examples of events that are run through the guidance and counseling department, either in school or after school, so that our students have the most exposure to feel the most prepared at the end of their 4 years. We start off for their eighth, ninth grade transition with the curriculum night. We recently had that, and it was a wonderful event, very well attended. We offer a career fair that's happening in early March. We do college night for juniors. We do junior conferences. We offer financial aid night, and our FAFSA completion event is this coming Monday for anybody who would like to attend. It has been moved. Normally, it's much earlier in the fall, but FAFSA is different this year. But things that happen in the building that maybe people aren't aware of, that is a major function of the guidance office, is that we have a regular flow of college, trade school, and military visits that are coming into the building that we are helping our students to access through the guidance office. So they are having an opportunity during their school day to meet and discuss what is available at colleges, trade schools, and in the military, so that they can be informed as to the choices for when they are seniors and what they're going to take part in. We do something called on-site admissions, in which we bring in local colleges and universities for students to apply in person during their school day. And it's a really great program, because very often students will walk out not only with an admissions decision, but with a scholarship offer from a school. So it's a really exciting thing. It builds students' confidence, and they walk around the hallways that day knowing, I have a choice of someplace that I can go next year. We offer the military recruitment support, where our military representatives can come into the building, meet with students and families if they would like to. But we also offer ASVAB testing, which is the entrance exam in a way, if you think about it, or placement testing for the military. That can happen during school day, and students are eligible to partake in that as with an excused absence, so that they have that opportunity. If they do sit for the ASVAB, there is no military requirement, but it gives them the opportunity to explore that path after high school. And we also, through our office, run the local scholarships program, and we recognize all of our military student enlisted students in June. Really what I want to focus on and say that the difference between middle school and high school is where middle school, we're talking about the social and emotional academic piece of things. In high school, we really have an academic, career, and personal development focus, where those are the things that are at the forefront. So we are making sure that every student is getting what they need to explore the path that is unique to them when they leave ConnectQuad High School. Just some stats that I want to review for the graduating class of 2023 that I think we should be very proud of. The numbers that you see on screen represent what our students did, but also how we compare to the national averages. So last year, 60% of our graduates attended four-year college and university. The national average last year, as reported by the Bureau of Labor Statistics, was 45%. We also had, so again, you read down the numbers, and we are exceeding expectation or norm across the board in all areas. Uniquely so that even exceeding the NCAA average. So, and that where that is unique and we really want to commend our students is not only are they wonderful athletes, but they are wonderful students, because to be an NCAA Division I, II, or III athlete, you have to not only have the athletic skill, but you have to meet academic requirement and eligibility to play at that level. So we are almost double the national average of how many students we send from Kennecticut High School to play at the division level at college. So that's something that we're very proud of our students. And also in our standardized testing, we are outscoring national averages across the board for SATs and ACT testing. And then last year, our students, because of their wonderful skill in the classroom, but also outside of the classroom in who they are as individuals, they were awarded over $100,000 in scholarships from local businesses and charities and organizations from the community. So we're very proud of not only what we're doing in school, but how we're preparing students for after school. And we're happy to see that everybody else is seeing that as well. Thank you.
Thank you. And just for any seniors or any parents out there, this Thursday is the local scholarship information meeting. Correct?
Yes. Thursday night at 7 o'clock at the Kennecticut High School auditorium. So I'll see you there.
I just have a question. Thank you.
Yeah.
First, you know, these are great stats, and thank you for putting that together. And if you don't know this answer, don't worry about it. Do you know what the most popular BOCES classes are?
We don't have too big of an enrollment in any one area, but if there wasn't something that had slightly more, it would be the electrical and electricity program. HVAC is very popular with our students. Cosmetology is, I would say, third. It used to be more popular, but not as much lately. But I would say the electrical program and HVAC are definitely our two most popular, but it's not anything that is far and away above the others.
Okay. I just was curious. I know a lot of schools offer it in-house, so I wanted to see, you know, what the need was or, you know.
Yeah.
Thank you.
No problem. Thanks. Okay. Thank you.
Good evening. Buenas tardes a todos. I was going to do the whole thing in another language, but I just thought, you know, we'd be up here way too long. And after Joe Licato. No, I am multilingual. She is multilingual as well.
You know how I feel. Know.
Y por esto te quiero mucho, sabes, chica. Huh?
Yo sé, okay. Señora Sosa.
Okay, so I will begin with our middle school experience. We have, as you can see, a wonderful success rate with our students. You can read, I'm not gonna read them to you. This year, for the first time, I'm so happy that we have our sixth graders having an experience with language, with world language, with French and Italian. They do have the experience in elementary school for Spanish, so for them to have exposure to something different, I think is really amazing for them. There we go. Okay. In our Flex B, which is given to our students at the high school, again, we have 100% passing rate in French and Italian and almost a perfect passing rate in Spanish as well. We have our students almost hitting the mastery rate for mastery, which is really quite amazing. And we have 99 students from last year. This year, we might have a little bit less because our enrollment is a little bit lower. That they enroll through St. John's, and in this concurrent partnership, they earn 3 to 6 credits at the intermediate level in world language, in Spanish, French, or Italian. Some of our students are enrolled in more than one world language, and it's an awesome opportunity for them. Yeah. This is... Nope. Put it down. Thank you, Jeff. Okay. I apologize. The Seal of Biliteracy, I'm so happy to say that we are now considered a veteran Seal of Biliteracy school. Last year we had 99 students who earned the seal. And the reason the number is different than the number that Mike gave you is because the juniors don't actually receive their seal until they are seniors. We did have a few students who are juniors who are heritage or native speakers who sat for the seal. The Seal of Biliteracy is awarded by the state of New York. It is a rigorous program where students must do a research project and present it to their peers and to colleagues. For the past 2 weeks, I've been sitting in on all of the presentations, and I cannot tell you how impressed I am with the students, what they are producing. They're doing critical thinking at a level that is just amazing. So I'm really proud of the students, I'm proud of the staff, and I'm proud of ConnectQuad that we have this program, and we've had it for 5 years. So this, I think, is something that's really awesome. And then, thank you, Jess. Our ENL population is growing, as we all know. This is America, after all. And we have a lot of events for these students. At the high school, we have about 15 languages represented. This is a photo from our Thanksgiving celebration from last year. We also took them to Bryant Park. They did some ice skating. They got to experience some real culture. And they have opportunities at the high school to integrate with our gen ed students, and they also have extra activities that they are awarded through their Title III grant. Okay, y muchas gracias por todo. Especially Jess.
We just have one question, Ms. Sosa. Sorry.
I'm so sorry. Yes. I have a question for you. Have you seen, and I know over the last 5 years, I remember a few years ago we had some issues with French having a very low enrollment. Are you seeing more people taking interest in it? Are you seeing more encouraging of taking it? Because I know French is a language that people say is the language of love, and the language is outside of ConnectQuad is something that a lot of people say is used worldwide, more so than even how we have so many kids with Spanish and Italian because it's more common.
Yeah, that's a very good question. And a lot of parents ask about, you know, why French? Why is, honestly, a student should be taking a language that they feel passionate about, not because they think their parent says you should take Spanish because everybody speaks Spanish. And, you know, French is actually one of the most important languages for science and mathematics. And there are probably, I don't know the figures, but a large number of countries that French is their national language. Mm-hmm. And so we have seen an increase in the interest in French. We've been trying to grow the program. Which is why I'm hoping the kids, when they experience French in the middle school, that there'll be a new interest in it. Our enrollment in the high school is going up in French.
Perfect.
We hired an amazing French teacher who is doing an amazing job. She has 5 preps, but she's doing an amazing job. So I hope that answers your question.
No, it doesn't. To be perfectly honest, I didn't even realize what was going on in the middle school. So thank you, because that's great, because we saw in the elementary school how popular it was, how many kids are willing to go to the lunch and learn. Yeah. And it's nice to see children at a younger age, their love for language.
Absolutely.
It really is nice.
Yep. The younger the start, the better off they are. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you, Ms. Sosa. I'll talk to you guys briefly here about just some data for social studies. So these are our social studies regents numbers. These are all numbers that are between 10 and 15 higher, 10 and 15 percentage points higher than the county average. So we're very proud of this. We've always prided ourselves on being a high achieving district when it comes to our social studies numbers. So this is just kind of more of the same for us. We're very proud of this. And like I said, if you look at our numbers compared to the entire county, these are going to be very, very impressive numbers. Very similar when we talk about the AP exams, you can see that those percentage of 3 or higher really speak for themselves. You can see AP World History popping off the page, AP Government Politics, those numbers are also off the charts when you look at state and national averages. And even AP US History, which, you know, compared to those other numbers might look like it's a little bit low. But the impressive thing about that is that course is still well above state and national average when you talk about percentage of three or higher. And that's with 40% of the entire 11th grade taking that course. So that's like I said, it may look like it pales a little bit compared to some of these other grades. But when you talk about, you know, 40% as opposed to 10, 15% of the grade taking the exam, you can see how impressive that number is.
And can I just, on that note, do you think it's because it's a two-year course?
U.S. is one. The world is two. Why the world number is so high?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so the world number, that's probably a big part of it. We give them a pre-AP World 9 in ninth grade, so they develop all the skills in ninth grade that they need for the AP exams, for the Part 2s, for the writing. And that's one of the things when the students jump from eighth grade to ninth grade, when they go from eighth grade honors to ninth grade, a lot of them, it's kind of a shock, and there's a little bit of a, like, wow factor to it. But then they kind of get acclimated, and we see the payoff down the road when we get that 91% of our kids getting three or higher. So, yes, the two-year course absolutely helps when we're talking about getting those grades to be where they are. And then, you know, we have eight. Sorry, there's a lot of AP data here. But again, all of these, you know, again, micro, macroeconomics jumping off the page. But again, every single one of these numbers that I'm displaying are going to be significantly above the state and national averages, some by pretty significant margins. I know we talked a lot about dual credit opportunities, and, you know, my department, especially business, has always been kind of the banner of the high school when it comes to dual credit opportunities. We have 13 different business classes that offer college credits, up to 36 college credits. Part of the reason we use that three or higher as the barometer for AP exams is because that's generally what you need to get college credit. Some schools it's a little bit higher, but three is the minimum of what you need to earn on your AP exams to get college credit. But it's not just the AP kids that can get the college credit. And that's why we have all these other dual credit opportunities. So if you're a business student that may not be in AP microeconomics, or may not be in AP biology, but you still want to kind of advance yourself financially with your college prep, we have all these courses. So 36 different college classes available from Stony Brook, Post, and Farmingdale for business. And then social studies is really kind of recently jumping into the fray there. We, 3 or 4 years ago, we didn't have any social studies electives that ran as dual credit electives for college credit. And now we're up to 7 different classes that you know, can get you up to 24 college credits. Maybe even more beneficial than the financial aspect of it is the preparatory aspect of it. You know, we have some of our students that go through our business academy, which I'll talk about in a second, that will get, you know, upwards of 24, 27 credits. And it's not just the credits that they get, but they get to these classes and they're taking 200-300 level classes in college. And they say, I can teach this class. And this is a 200 level class because they were so immersed in it in high school. So that's something that we, you know, we really pride ourselves on as a department. In terms of business, speaking of points of pride, our virtual enterprise class is the capstone for our business department, for our business academy. And that class has always been successful. Mr. Jaffares does a wonderful job with that class. But really in the last several years, 2 years ago, we had a VE firm, you might have heard of them, that was the best achieving VE firm that we've ever had. They were the most awarded, had the most accolades. And then, of course, last year, they were one-upped by our first ever VE firm that made it to Nationals for business plan. So we're just seeing, you know, incredible amounts of success. And we've actually, it's crazy, we've opened the class up to more students. We used to restrict it to one section. Now we've opened it up to two sections, and we've actually seen a lot more success. Might not necessarily be a causation correlation thing. It could just be data, but it could be noisy. But I think there is the idea of getting more kids involved, getting, you know, fresher ideas, getting, you know, different clientele of kids involved. And we're really starting to reap the benefits of that. And we actually just found out this morning that one of our firms for this year is moving on for their firm. So that's really impressive for that. Business Academy is something that we started 3 years ago. The whole idea is this, is to get students as involved in business as possible from a young age. So there's state requirements to have an accredited Business Academy, which we have. You have to take personal finance, Microsoft Office, Virtual Enterprise, and a couple other classes. Our first year, we had 4 graduates. Last year, we had 10. This year, we're expecting about 15. And those kids get the New York State CTE designation. And the whole idea is, they get involved in business from a young age, the business classes, they take more classes, they get more credit, and they're more ready for college and for their careers. Ninth, we ran our first ever personal financial literacy day this year. You know, we have a belief that we want to get more of our students involved and acclimated to personal finance. We run the personal financial literacy course, which we generally run about 7 classes a year. So you're talking about, you know, 150 or so, 160 kids a year getting that. But in a school of 1,700, you're talking about 1,500 kids a year who are not getting the personal finance aspect. So we ran a personal financial literacy day for the entire ninth grade. And we had a local financial advisor come in. We had our business academy kids, our entire business department all ran different parts of that. The students moved throughout the building and they learned budgeting and they learned saving for college and they learned what a paycheck looks like in taxation. And you know, they did a whole, you know, experiment with them of, you know, you may think, okay, I'm 13, 14, 15 years old. How does the decision I make financially matter today? Well, they did this whole thing, okay, would you rather have a cup of coffee today or would you rather not buy coffee all week and have $65,000 when you're 60 years old? And you see some of the kids like, a cup of coffee is worth $65,000. Well, now it's not, but a cup of coffee a week for the next however many years, you know, if you invest it, yes, it is. And it was cool to see the kids kind of like, oh yeah, so maybe some of the decisions I make now actually do have an impact. So that was really cool for us to see as well. We had a job fair, not to be confused with the career fair. Ms. Rapone ran a job fair last year, and different from getting kids ready for their, you know, long-term careers, this was local businesses came in and offered seasonal jobs and long-term part-time jobs for students who could apply right on the spot. Some of them got hired literally right on the spot at the high school library. We had other kids fill out working papers. We had other kids talk to the businesses and talk about, you know, what are you looking for? What do you need? When can I start? This and that. And that we're running another one this year on March 26th. Last year, we had 10 businesses. We're expecting to have 20 plus businesses this year. And it's available to every student 9 through 12 throughout the entire high school. So that's just getting kids, again, not necessarily their career, but kids that are looking for work. And then they can work with Ms. Rapone in the school to work program and kind of use that as a growing, you know, part of their high school experience. And finally for me, kind of my passion project over the last couple of years is our esports program. We started this 2 years ago as a...
Who said you can't play video games for the rest of your
nice way to like meet new friends, play with friends.
Welcome to the Thunderdome, the new esports lab at Connect Quad High School. There are 16 stations and 24 students on the team roster who compete across four different games: Valorant, Rocket League, Minecraft, and chess. The teams compete against others in the high school esports league.
We hold practices throughout the week. It's not just show up and you get to compete. You have to earn your spot on the team.
The consoles, coaches,
some students couldn't wait to sign up.
They were really stressed. Like, whenever I was at, like, touching, putting my game on, I was really happy.
The high school is also adding an esports course next year.
The class is going to be Washington Computer Science, Washington Business. And what it's going to do is it's just all the different computers that are available.
This guy already has
a plan. I've got a battery side, like a developer, and finding for a college.
One of the varsity teams was undefeated heading to the playoffs and finished in the top 16. One of the JV teams made it to the semifinals. Okay. Video games didn't make Amy. It was at our family in television, and it was probably Pac-Man.
So that kind of summarizes everything I was going to say about the program. But we, you know, we started last year. We did have four different teams competing across multiple games. And then this year we kind of added a curricular component to the extracurricular team that we had. We're running 40 plus students are in the full year classes, half business, half computer science. And they learn about, you know, the idea of, you know, you can't play video games for the rest of your life unless you're a pro, which is like 0.01% of them. But you can get involved in the advertising and the marketing and the design and the audio and the video creation and all that kind of stuff. So we're kind of trying to leverage the students' passions and kind of doing away with you can't play video games for the rest of your life to, well, maybe you can if you kind of follow a certain path. So that's kind of the whole, you know, summary of our esports program. All
right. Thank you. Yeah. I also think that it's important to note on the college courses that it's through LIU, Farmingdale, and Stony Brook, but those aren't the only colleges that accept the credits.
No, that, yeah.
They're
yeah, right.
Accepted.
Almost every SUNY will accept them, especially the Farmingdale and the Stony Brook ones, because obviously they're partnered together. But most of the, so I don't want to say most, but a lot of schools nationwide will accept those college credits.
Right. And as far as the esports being a class, As an elective or like through one of the...
No, it's an elective. So okay. The way they take it is they get a half a business credit for it and a half a computer science credit for it. But it is an elective. So you have to have a full period open in your schedule to be able to take it for the full year. So it's a bit of a commitment.
It's a full year class?
It's a full year class, yeah. Okay. So we kicked it around a couple different ways to maybe do just a half year. But you know, the more we thought about it, we wanted the kids to get exposure to the business side and to the computer science side. We thought that was important for them to get the full experience.
And quick question. How many sections are you doing of this? Is it just one or are you doing
right,
two?
This year we have one section. We don't know it for next year yet because they're doing the scheduling process now.
Are you seeing an increase? Because I can tell you, I would think that this is a great class, especially the boys at my house a lot, I can see them all wanting to take it.
Yeah, no, it's awesome. And I think what the biggest thing for the teachers is obviously the kids just want to play every day. You know, yeah. Can we play? So the way we do it is each of the classes goes in twice a week. So they do 3 days of instruction and then 2 days of play. And we call it purposeful play. So they're supposed to apply the stuff that they learned in class to what they're playing with.
That's very cool.
You can get my son in there for 9 periods.
Yeah. I can put a lot of kids in there for nine periods. Yeah.
I'm only asking because I'm wondering if there is an overabundance of children who want to take it. I would love to see more than one section, especially if it's something that they're really interested in.
Yeah, no, listen, we would love to get that. Obviously, the numbers are going to dictate it, and it is a little bit harder. A lot of the younger kids are the ones that are more passionate about it, and they're the ones that have a little bit less room in their schedule. So we do see it filling up with mainly 10th and 11th graders. We haven't opened it up to 9th graders yet just because of a couple different reasons. But you know, if we want, we have explored potentially opening up to 9th grade in the future. So we'll see what the numbers look like this year, and we'll go from there.
Is there a retro component for those vintage gamers like me?
It's funny you ask that. There is within the course itself. They do a whole history, and they go into like Atari, and they show videos. It's hard to get your hands on those things.
Oh my God,
we
Atari.
Actually looked into. Yeah, we looked into getting like an Atari or like an original Nintendo and stuff. We could, but you know, but we did talk about making like a whole retro. They actually did a project this year, and it was the history of video games. So some of the kids actually did presentations on. So
would you still have the club?
Yeah, so they function, the way I describe it is kind of like the club is your varsity team and the class is your gym class. You know, phys ed class.
Thank you.
Yes.
I have some questions too. First of all, the esports is fantastic. My fifth grader would like to do it now. He loves Rocket League.
Oh, Rocket League, that's one of our big games.
But my question actually, I'm going to go back to one of your slides about the Regents courses, the passing grades, and the mastery level, the global history and the U.S. history, those numbers. We were, the board was recently given some data over a 5-year period of how well the students did, how many students scored within ranges, how many students mastered, how many students got the next level of grades, and a comparison to their final grades. And one of the things I noticed, and I know COVID is that year was. It was rough, and it definitely made a change. And one of the things that I saw a significant change was in the 2018-2019 year, we had over 80% of the students that mastered the AP U.S. History exam, which is absolutely incredible.
The Regents or the AP?
What's that?
The Regents exam or the AP exam?
I think it's the AP exam. I think it's the AP exam. I think the AP...
It's the Regents.
It's the Regents.
Yeah.
Which one am I looking at? Yes. And it went down now.
The Regents. You're looking at the Regents.
I know. I'm looking at them all.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So our historical data for the AP for regular U.S. history is always going to be in that 80 or so percent range. The data I gave you from last year, it's a new exam. So what happened is, if you look back, you can go back for 15, 20 years. We were always in that like high 70 to low 80 percentage of mastery in U.S. history. This year, last year when we gave the Regents, I remember when the grades started coming back, everyone was panicking because we're like, oh my God, what is happening? The essays looked good, the parts, because we see them, we grade the tests. So the essays look good, the part twos look good. Everything was like as it normally is. The kids were doing really well. And then all of a sudden the grades kick back and we had AP kids that never would be below 90 in the 80s. You know, and we had regular Regents level kids that would normally, you know, be in the high 80s, mid 80s, all of a sudden in the low to mid 70s. And we were kind of in a panic. And it ended up being like every social studies director across the island was calling each other, like, what's going on, this and that. The state changed the conversion chart when they changed the exam. So they essentially kind of pushed down the mastery rates across the board. So that's why when you look at the county numbers, if you were to run that exact same report for any county, any district in the state, you're going to see the same thing. You're going to see a pretty significant drop in the mastery rate. The passing rate will actually come up. They kind of pushed it towards the middle a little bit. But that's why those U.S. numbers look a little bit different than they have in the past.
Do you have any idea what we can do? And it's not just for your for business or social studies. This actually applies to all that I'm seeing. When we're looking at this kind of data, this was what I had asked for last year, which was AP classes. I've seen students who can get 100 in the class, but then come in with a 2 or 3 on the AP exam. What can we do to improve that? Like, I understand that some students may have test anxiety. Some students may be able to study for something, but not one of those big tests. Is there a test taking? I've said this in the past. Is there something we can do collectively or look to do to try to improve not just those grades, but maybe that would also help with our rankings? And that, as we're saying, even though we come in the 200 and 300s, it would be nice to even come in lower.
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, that's obviously something that we would have to collaborate on as an entire kind of district. Just from my perspective, I think you kind of hit the nail on the head when you talk about kids that maybe, you know, there's levels of anxiety when you get to testing. There's kids, you know, we saw even when we were doing the presentations tonight, there's kids that are in 6, 7, 8 AP tests. I run the testing up at the high school. There will be kids that I'll actually have to take and move their tests to later testing windows because they have too many tests scheduled and they're all overlapping. So that could be, you know, it could just be a symptom of that. And ultimately, those tests are hard too. You know, they're designed to test the top of the top kids. And some of the issues that I know, like I mentioned with the AP US history, we have such a large percentage of our kids taking it that it may just, they do well, so well throughout the school year because they're completing their assignments and they're doing their homework and they're writing their essays and they are high level children or high level students. But then when you get those exams that are basically designed to test the top of the top in terms of, you know, your acumen and your ability, I think that just could be part of the reason that the grades are skewed too. But that's not to say we can't do it. It's just something that we'd have to explore kind of myself and all the other directors and see what, you know, is causing it. But I, you know, ultimately our grades are pretty strong, you know, especially if you look at our 12th grade numbers, our 10th grade, I mean, they are really, really strong numbers. So I wouldn't say that they need vast improvement, but I think you can always find areas of improvement, you know?
Mine was just because, like I said, I've had parents say to me, you know, my kid got 100 in the class, got a 99 in the class, and then gets a 2 or 3 on the exam. And I said, three they take. Yeah. But they'll be like, no, but how do you get it? And I said, I don't know if it's just some students with test taking.
Yeah, it could be, and it's hard. Like I said, it's something that we'll have to work on, you know, as a group. But I don't have the answer for you right now. I wish I did. All right, anything else? All right, thank you guys.
Ms. Napolitano-Ferno, in response to that, you know, we also have quite a dedicated faculty behind those courses, and they offer extensive, you know, practice before exams. Some of the frustration also occurs because we don't score those exams per se, right? They go out to the College Board and they come back with a number. And so there is a little less of a local control to that, which can be frustrating also. But I know that we have certainly dedicated faculty and dedicated administrators to kind of working on your question.
No, and I apologize if I put Mr. Kassane on the spot. It was just because he was up there saying, it's just, I've been asked so many times, and I know I've asked you over the years about this. This isn't anything new, that I just always have the same question asked to me. And I tell them I really don't have an answer other than I always have said, maybe we can do something with test-taking strategies. Maybe we can help that way. I don't really, you would know better than me, what's a way that we can help students so that when they have these big tests, this is why I was asking about the SAT preps and all that. What can we do to help students who are, regardless if they're high achievers or not, if you're taking a class, how can you, if you're getting a 90 in a class or a 95 in the class that's that hard, I'm just saying, how can we help them also be more successful on the test? And again, it's great seeing how successful a lot of students are, but it'll be great if we see 99% or 90% for every test. It might be me dreaming, but it's a nice thought.
All right, so let's dive into the world of science, family and consumer sciences, and technology education. I am going to talk about the middle school experience, but I want to first start with the data, so we'll front load that. On the screen right now, you have the four major core content areas for science that are taught, earth science for accelerated students in both middle schools, and then earth science, living environment, chemistry, and physics taught at the high school. These core courses are still being run off of the 96 MST standards. Those standards are no longer the adopted standards for New York State. So as you'll see in subsequent slides, with the shift to the NISLA standards that were adopted back in 2016, we are very soon going to be seeing a shift in the exams that are rolling out statewide for all four of these core content areas. In fact, we won't even call them the core, and they won't have the same titles of courses anymore either. Our passing and mastery rates very strong departmentally from 8th all the way through the 12th grade experience. And I did not highlight all the iterations of courses that we run. So we run ICT, we run regular Regents Load, we run honors courses. There are students in some of the AP courses that finish the year as a Regents student, so they're taking two exams in 1 year. So you have all of that compiled on the screen here. But if I dive more deeply into the data for the five AP areas that the students are able to experience in science, AP Environmental Science is our shining star in the department. We have an average score departmentally of a 4.2 out of 5. It is the highest scoring exam. I'm very proud of the staff and the students who have sat for this exam. They far exceed statewide, national, and global averages for that course. We run AP Biology as an experience for some students in ninth grade, where they take it for a double period every day, 10 periods a week, or for other students who can fit it into their schedule in their junior or senior year. We offer AP Chemistry, AP Physics 1, and then you'll notice also on the screen AP Physics C. That course has two exams tied to it. AP Physics 1 is an algebra-based course, and then the AP Physics C for the mechanics and the electricity and magnetism, those are calculus-based courses. The students have to be co-enrolled in a calculus course in addition to taking that AP Physics C course. Now, if I backtrack a little bit, I want to talk about the experience that students can have across the 6 through 12 science curricular approach. When students enter sixth grade and then move through seventh grade, they take their typical Science 6 or Science 7 courses. Those are currently being taught under the adopted standards from 2016. Which are called NISLIS. On the screen, you'll see that there's a little sort of circular triangle diagram here, which shares the 3D aligned approach to teaching science K to 12, or actually PK to 12, across the state, which incorporates the use of science and engineering practices along with disciplinary core ideas and the cross-cutting concepts that are critical for students to get a hold of and to be able to apply knowledge that they're learning in the classroom to case studies, data analysis, and real-world problems that are presented to them as they go through their science approach. When they reach eighth grade, they do have the option of accelerating into the earth science course, which next year is changing its title and the entire framework of the course. It's going to be called Earth and Space Sciences. It is an entirely new curriculum. The teacher's been working for several years, myself included. We rolled this out back in 2013 when we just had the framework of the standards that we were working with to try to build different experiences for the students in the classroom so we weren't just dumping everything into one single year to prepare ourselves to move forward with getting ready for a new assessment. We are looking at for the 6 through 8 experience right now, there are mandated investigations that New York State they shared statewide last October of 2022. So we were able to get the materials and supplies for that. And the teachers have been doing a really awesome job with incorporating those investigations into the 6th, 7th, and 8th grade science courses. And we also have now gotten the supply lists, although incomplete, we have some supply lists from the state that were updated actually just yesterday. And we are looking to acquire the materials for Earth and Space Science and for our rebranded Living Environment course, which is going to be called Life Science, colon, Biology as we move forward. So that brand new course, along with Earth and Space Science, for the regions to be a component of a student's end of year, they are going to have a 1,200 lab minute requirement, which is already in place for all of the regents classes, but they must also complete these mandated investigations. Now, our current Living Environment course already has mandated labs, but they are changing as we transition to the NISLIS regents exam. They will then, in another couple of years, roll out a similar format for the new rebranded chemistry and the new rebranded physics courses. So we have a lot of changes happening departmentally, K to 12, 6 to 12, the new Regents exams, again, for Earth and Space, and also for our Life Science Biology will occur in June of 2025. With just one single class moving forward with a Living Environment exam that year. That is our two-year Living Environment G class. They will complete the course that they're currently enrolled in 1G right now. And then the following year, June of 26, is when we're looking to roll out the brand new chemistry and brand new physics. But I also have family and consumer science and technology to talk about. So family and consumer science, oh, and I forgot to mention the dual enrollment course. We run three sections right now of an 8-credit college-bearing course called College Medical Anatomy and Physiology. Very popular for students who are in the department who want to move into any of the medical fields. Mrs. Dosh is the current teacher of that, and the students earn those 8 credits from CW Post. The dual enrollment course that we offer also through POST for our family and consumer science thread of classes is called Nurturing Young Children's Development. It is the third in an iteration of courses about child and adolescent psychology. So that course was rebranded last year and continues this year with one section. Overall, in our 6 through 12 approach to family and consumer sciences, we have mandated credits that need to be presented in that field in the middle school experience. So our 6th and 7th graders all take family and consumer sciences. There they get an introduction to cooking and baking and safe practices in kitchens. They also work through a unit or a couple of projects using textiles and learning about the sewing process. And they also are incorporating personal financial literacy into those courses. I've seen some really phenomenal lessons that talk about family budgeting processes. How do you plan to have the appropriate type of loans that you're taking out for college? Or how can you plan to save for college? I like how my colleague behind me here was talking about not buying coffee all the time. Like, that's a conversation that they have in 6th and 7th grade family and consumer science as well. And then they save a certain amount over the course of 35 years, and you've got a boatload of money to hopefully invest well and not spend all at one time. In recent news at the high school, our high school family consumer science teachers have just submitted a proposal to Mrs. Necken's office because she is the AP in charge of clubs. This is for the FCCLA, which is a club, but it is sort of like a quasi-honor society for family and consumer sciences. So the students in this particular organization, if it is adopted and moved forward in the future, they will actually get to compete with peers locally, and then perhaps if we do well, nationally as well, in the areas that are listed above, cooking and baking, sewing and textiles, personal financial literacy, and other areas as well. So we're hoping that that is something that they'll go into meetings next month to consider as a new club at the high school. And then in terms of technology education, we actually offer 2 credit-bearing college courses, which will kick off next Monday. For that advanced automotive, it's 3 credits, and also for robotics, it's 3 credits. One of them is through Farmingdale, and the other is through Suffolk Community College. We have some exciting news in terms of technology education for our robotics program. Both robotics middle school teams are going to the first LEGO League Challenge this Saturday. It's being held at William Floyd High School. And then our high school robotics first team will be competing again at the, they always have a competition for this locality held at Hofstra. That'll be right in the middle of March. It's 3 days in March. They just got their robot kit and they will receive their laptops tomorrow. Thank you so much to our peers in the IT department for programming the laptops with Linux GUI. We really appreciate it.
I have a couple of questions about the new sciences that are coming in. I know that you said that the new Earth and Space Science is for next year.
Yep.
And then the Living Environment /
next year.
Is life also science, next biology. Year?
Yep.
So if you were set to take Living Environment next year, you're now going to take the new one?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. And Earth Science as well. And that'll be for the 8th grade Earth Science experience and the 9th grade Earth Science experience.
First, I want to say good luck to the students. That's really awesome.
Yes. So
best of luck to them.
Yeah, I can't wait to see them compete. It's a really neat setup they're working with this year for their first LEGO masterpiece.
But I do have a question too, you know, sort of similar because I've been looking at grades and the trends and how things are going. And one of the things that I did notice last year, maybe you have an explanation for this, is that it seemed that for the physics regions, you had, you know, 90% of the students that did very well in the courses overall. Okay. But yet the exam, you know, as we saw in here, 39%. Is there a reason for the similar to what you were saying, that they do so well in the course itself, but then the exam, it doesn't quite reflect that or
So there's a bit of disconnect with the numbers there. There have been scheduling challenges at the end of the year with things like New York State sets the exam date for the regents for physics, which is something that seniors and juniors take. And they set that after we have already selected our date for the prom and graduation. So in the case of the last couple of years, we have had a challenge where the prom is either the night before, and then the physics regents was on graduation day last June. And then this year, coming up in June, the physics regents will be in the morning. The prom is in that evening, and graduation is the next day. Because of just the wacky way that we have early June testing for certain exams. I'm sure Mrs. Burgo will refer to that in a few minutes. And then later on in the month, we have the majority of the regents exams. And then you have things like Juneteenth or Eid where there are no tests given on those days. So it's just something that we have to contend with the entire schedule.
Is there some sort of magic that we can do to
I was going to piggyback off of that and see if there's anything we can propose to the state to see if maybe they can consider offering the exam earlier. Right?
Yes, we have tried for many years. We've also asked for many years for the students to be allowed to use graphing calculators, since now you can put them into test mode and things like that. But the state is slow to change.
Well, because the other unfortunate thing is that the physics regions, there's no makeup till January. It's not offered in the summer.
Right.
So,
and it's a secure test in January. Too,
correct.
So it's the same one.
So that's
year.
That's another, just.
I mean, I don't know. Advocate.
The Board of Regents. You would have to advocate to the state and the Board of Regents. We could do that.
Yeah.
It would just, we would need your guys' help to tell us what exactly direction to go.
Yes. Probably and the Office of State Assessment would be a good approach there first.
Absolutely.
Zach Warner.
So, Ms. Poppy, if you can work with Ms. Burns and any other directors that if there's anything we're looking to advocate for, this would probably be through the Board of Regents, right?
Yeah.
And we could get that all nice one-stop shopping, and then we could draft the advocacy letter for the board to vet.
Advocate team.
That sounds good.
Not advocating, go.
Any other questions?
Thank you so much.
No, thank you so much.
Good evening. How's everybody doing? Good? All right.
My click, Jess, you want to click for my cue? You can click, Jess, if you want. Good. All right. Oh, there you go. You got it. You click. All right. So that's it. Is this working? Yeah. I guess it's the Italian, right, Joe? We got to move around. The Italians have to move around. Okay. So it's getting late. I'm going to be brief. I'm going to present in almost bullet form because I want to leave you with maybe just one thought for some of the things that we offer in the world of health and physical education. I will start with a blanket statement. There is no question at all that our subject area is much more important than it was 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, et cetera. This is not our parents or our physical education, health education program that we were used to. It's very different. It's kind of a good news, bad news. Here's the deal. We're more important, which helps the teachers. They feel needed. They feel engaged. They feel important. That's the good news. And we're there to help kids. We are trying. And I think we are. The bad news is the reason they need us is not good. It's because of the problems with whether it be social media, mental health, drugs and alcohol, vaping. We know the whole routine. So we are here. We're here for the kids. This subject area is more important. It is not more important or less important than any other subject area. But I will say this. We tie in because we all know this as adults and especially for kids. I don't care how smart you are. I don't care how great of a musician you are. I don't care how great of an athlete you are. If you don't feel good about yourself, if you are not physically healthy, if you are not mentally healthy, if you don't know the resources and you don't know where to get help, you cannot succeed in what is required in the academic areas and you cannot succeed in your passions. And that's why we're important. So let's roll it right into health education, grade 6 through 12. Again, getting back to traditional health that you and I grew up with, we are not doing just food pyramids, goal setting, and the bad effects of drugs and alcohol. We are emphasizing mental health. One of the most important things that we're teaching is the recognition. Students having the ability to recognize what mental health is and are they having an issue. Breaking the stigma. I will say this is a good thing. We have progressed. Years ago, if somebody said I'm depressed and they were in eighth grade, like, what do you mean you're depressed? You're in eighth grade. How could you be depressed? No, there is no more stigma anymore with mental health. But we do go over that it's okay if you don't feel good. It's okay if you have an issue. And now what are we going to do about it? We as health teachers are certainly going to give them the resources to cope, coping skills. We're giving them resources externally in the school setting and outside the school, okay? We work collaboratively, the health teachers, with all teachers and the social workers and the psychologists and the administration to make sure we are promoting positive mental health for all. And the Mental Health Advisory Committee, which many of you sit on, has been a huge boost to the overall wellness and mental health of our kids. Grade 6 health education, what I like what we do here, that doesn't go on in every middle school. The students have it every other day for a year. And that's important because how do we know a sixth grader who's moving along nicely in that first semester doesn't start experiencing some issues, whether it be they've been exposed to drugs or alcohol. Maybe their parents got divorced and they're having a rough time. So our health teacher is still connected every other day from September through June. So I like the way we do that for the sixth grade. We have Aaron's Law incorporated to our curriculum. We did curriculum writing for that. That was a law that came in from the state in 2019. And we're going to touch on personal safety, healthy and unhealthy relationships, abuse, sexual abuse, and even child abduction. Obviously, we do age appropriate with that grade 6 through 12. But by the mandate, we did incorporate Aaron's Law. We are proud to say, thanks to the Board of Education a number of years ago promoting this and helping us with this, we do not teach regular health anymore in 12th grade. That was too late. So every ninth grader has the option to take health. If it doesn't fit in their schedule, we have some outstanding music students that fill up in ninth grade. We offer it to them in 10th grade. Okay, so by ninth and 10th grade, we've reached these kids earlier than later, and they have their health. Any questions on health education? Okay. Physical education, again, this is not the traditional phys ed that we grew up with. Yes, we still do a unit called basketball. Kids have to play. You know this. Kids do not go out in the street and play anymore. They don't problem solve. They don't socialize. They don't get air and fresh energy and air and run around and move. They just don't do it unless they're involved in athletics. And we have a lot of students not involved in athletics. So phys ed has become more important in that sense. So we have the traditional activities, but all our ninth graders will take Project Adventure as part of the ninth grade course. It's a great unit. We do problem solving, cooperation, risk taking, and the kids get to know each other, which is really important as they come in from different middle schools. During ninth grade, they'll also take swimming. Some schools have done away with swimming. We are proud that we still do swimming. Kids learn the four basic strokes. Everybody should graduate high school with the ability to save themselves and or swim and even maybe save others. They don't have to take the lifeguarding course, but in ninth grade, they do learn ways that they can save themselves if they get in trouble in the water. And then we are incorporating mental health into physical education by a lot of yoga and meditation classes. They are awesome. 2 weeks ago, I went to observe one. I put down my laptop, and instead of typing up the observation, I joined in, and I almost fell asleep. That's how relaxed I got. Okay, but that's important for those students through that yoga, that meditation, to take the stress from the day, de-stress, and then go out to the other subject areas and be successful. And one of the things I'm most proud of are our programs for our life skills and our adaptive kids. We have some outstanding teachers in the middle school and the high school. Ms. Burke, Ms. Leonard, and Mrs. Sewell at the high school is outstanding with our life school and adaptive kids. Anybody that has any kind of challenge, we are going to make sure they're in a setting where they receive the same benefits from phys ed and health in whichever way and however we can provide it to them. It's that simple. So we think out of the box. It could be something as simple as different equipment. It could be, you know, smaller groups. However, we also integrate these students into full regular classes when appropriate. Okay, and we give these kids, outstanding kids, lots and lots of choices. Some electives in phys ed, the last slide. We have the lifeguarding course, which is really popular. We're adding more sections every year. It's real simple. If the kids qualify to take the course through a pre-test, you have to be able to have a good swimming background. You enroll in the course, and Ms. Sewell will certify you over, well, she'll take you through the course over the year. And if you pass the test, which most kids have, they are certified to be a pool lifeguard, and we help them get job placements in the summer. And what's really cool is the kids that go to college come back, and Ms. Sewell runs what they call a recert in the spring when they come back, and we make sure the kids that went here or keep their jobs by getting recertified. So we should do that one night, which is great. We have our athletic training course with Mr. Alvarado. It's a nice elective. What I think is important, I remember when I taught this, I always felt this was a good, good positive to come out of it. Sometimes kids take the course and they realize they don't want to do this in college. They don't like this. That's a good thing. They just saved mom and dad a lot of money. They didn't spend 2 years enrolling in athletic training and then switch majors going into their junior year. So the athletic training class, kids find out this is it. I love this. I'm majoring this in college. And people go, yeah, maybe not. We ran last year emotional wellness through phys ed. That was a success, but the enrollment this year, the signups were lower. We did not run it. We are looking to potentially add health electives in the future, critical health and community health. And we're always looking to do fun events. And we did Desi Strong down at Ronk last year. Mrs. Hertz, Mr. Hertz, and the whole staff down there got that going. That was a lot of fun. And this year we are looking to raise money. Mr. Ingarosa, one of our adapted phys ed teachers, we're going to do a wheelchair basketball fundraiser, and we are going to use the money to pay for some of our wheelchair challenge students to participate in their wheelchair basketball leagues. That's fun stuff. Yeah. All right. Brief, short, to the point. We're good.
I got a question. Yes. First of all, thank you for all you're doing for our children that have disabilities. Appreciate it. Over the years, you brought in unified sports, and you've made it bigger, adding bowling. hopefully there's others that we can add. What are we doing in regards to some of these other students who maybe aren't as challenged, but still have maybe some other issues and would like to be involved in some of these classes? Do we have like a special education class for students that have disabilities? I know life skills is different, but something that still addresses and allows them to be part of it? Or are the kids all mixed? It doesn't matter if they're special ed or not.
There's a lot of different classifications. I think Lori would probably speak to that better. But for example, an 811 student would qualify for a life skills setting. And also with the collaboration, I mentioned that before, a lot of times we'll talk, hey, what's best for Joe Smith? Should he be integrated into the class? Let's talk to mom. What does mom want? What is best? We like gray sometimes. Everything can't be black and white. Kids are not black and white. They're gray. They're complicated. Our job is to find out how we can help them. So we have some kids completely integrated in classes that are physically challenged, maybe mentally challenged. We have other students that may have different disabilities, even less severe physical disabilities, but it's just not a good setting for them. So it's kind of individually based. And then obviously the special needs department will kind of give us guidance as to where they feel they belong. Right?
Spot on, Ms. Malloy.
Yeah. So.
Thank you. I just like to see that all of the kids were inclusive of it. And I know you are with, like I said, it's really very nice about the wheelchair disabilities and adding all these children together. Right. Love it.
And the best thing, one of the best things, and the board approved this, I think 3 years ago, is having one teacher, and I've said this before, we'll talk about him more because he's more in the elementary, that is just adapted. And he goes wherever we need him. So next year, if all of a sudden we have a new student coming in that needs, maybe he has to go to idle hour in the morning.
He's the one that travels, right?
I was
part of that. He's great.
He's fantastic.
And he's a good coach, too.
Yeah, he's a good coach. And, and an eighth grader, for example, all of a sudden becomes a high school student. Well, maybe Mr. Ingarosa has to go to the high school next year. So it's need-based. Okay?
Yeah. I have one question. I've had a lot of parents, because, it's scheduling time, ask me why the PE electives can't be counted towards the gym class. Like instead of, taking the gym classes, you get the lifeguard class. So they're, one of these.
Lifeguarding is counted. Athletic training is not.
Okay.
And I think it's because there's just less physical activity. Athletic training is truly in the classroom.
Okay, what about the emotional wellness? I know that was just said yoga and many things. I read it myself.
The wellness, if we ran it again, I think it should be counted as part of your phys ed.
Because I know students that wanted to take that, but the only reason they didn't, it's hard to fit in the schedule. And if it didn't count as their gym class, they couldn't take it.
Right, and that's something we could talk about, Ms. Poppy, Jess, we could talk about having it count for the, right, you're right. That would entice kids.
Oh, 100%.
100%, yeah. I agree.
Okay, so it's Ms. Christina Poppy I need to speak to?
I just want to be sure, I'm having a little trouble hearing.
Yeah, me too. I know.
So if a student enrolled in emotional wellness through physical education, which does have physical activity, a lot of yoga, meditation, so on and so forth, we would look at maybe having that, instead of being elective, count to the New York State phys ed credit, like lifeguarding does.
We would have to do a little bit of legwork and some research. We can do that collaboratively, of course.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ms. Malloy. Ms. Berger.
Hi, everyone. So, Mr. Hauser, I did like your formulas you had there did like that. And the problem solving is done in our classrooms. So here we have some of our most recent passing and mastery rates. Algebra 1 is given both middle schools as well as the high school level, geometry and algebra 2. Although it looks a little different than any of my other colleagues who have already been up here, let's take a look at that geometry number. The geometry number for mastery rate is a little bit lower than the New York State average. However, pre-COVID, it was about 20%. whereas the New York average was about 22 at the time. So it's always been a lower rate historically, going back pre-COVID. I think some of this had to do with the fact that we had the safety net, the safety appeals, rather, in effect. It is a more difficult exam to achieve that 85 or above based on the conversion chart. It's a lot that goes into actually converting a score. There's a lot that goes not just grading, and the gradings aren't out of 100 anymore. They're out of 82, 83. It fluctuates, it changes. So that's something that we recognize that is last year, is a little lower than our traditional averages, mastery rate-wise for geometry. Next year, the 24-25 school year, we are instituting a new course, almost an intervention-type course for students coming out of Algebra 1 going into geometry. It's a transition course. So they would be doing half algebra building skills, which will help them in the long run in Algebra 2, which I'll get to that in a moment. And the second half of the course will focus on the geometry that they will need for almost like preparing them to take the Regents Geometry course the following year.
This might sound like a silly question, but is there geometry in Algebra 1? Is that why it's in between Algebra 1 and Algebra 2?
There is a little bit of algebra in geometry, in the geometry course. What
geometry in Algebra 2?
Is there geometry in Algebra 2?
Like, why can't it be Algebra 1, Algebra 2, and then geometry? Like, why can't the algebras be in...
Some very few schools do that, and that's been a topic of conversation at the coordinators meeting. But pushing the geometry to the end, being the third course, so Algebra 1, Algebra 2, and then geometry, typically after that, you would take a pre-calculus and a calculus where you do need that Algebra 2 course.
So wherever
we put geometry, there is a gap.
Can I ask, based on these scores, which I didn't know earlier than today, why did we decide to get the tutors for Algebra 2 if our scores are so much lower in geometry?
Well, our scores really aren't that much lower. It's our mastery rate that's lower.
Well, 85, 65, that's 20%. I mean, that's failing and passing, you know, like, well, almost failing.
So let's take a look at the geometry passing rate of 65%. That is in line exactly with the New York average and the Eastern Suffolk BOCES region. It's actually a point above. So they're passing the exam. It's that shift up to 85 or above.
And it seems that the 65 to 84 range, it hasn't really dropped much from pre-COVID to now. Like, it's kind of in the same where there was such a drop in, you know, how the students were doing pre-COVID, how, you know, the number of students that mastered it versus now at the 6%, it seems that dipped a lot, where the other range, the 65 to 84, kind of stayed the same. You know, that's what I've, you know, seen from the numbers that we got from this poppy, that it's really
the mastery year that went down.
I don't think you guys understand that last year and the year before, there was an issue because of COVID, because the students who had Algebra 1,
you know, no, I understand that. The gap, right, but right, geometry is so different than algebra, so it would be its own course.
Algebra 2 is where you're seeing the most students needing tutoring. That's something totally different than what she's doing here. If you polled kids and said, hey,
you know what it is, though? From parents last year who spoke to me, so many kids failed that geometry regions. I wanted to know comparison, and you're not supposed to answer this now.
And last year we spoke.
Oh, see, so many failed about the geometry, and I'm just surprised that we're focusing on algebra 2.
Last year the messages that we got from students and speaking to Mrs. Poppy was that Algebra 2 was where there was serious problems because of Algebra 1. The kids that had Algebra 1 during COVID didn't get the same. Unfortunately, it was a tough year for all and a tough 2 years. And because of that, when they went into the Algebra 2 class, they were behind.
So to answer both of your questions, because April's talking about geometry, you're talking about Algebra 2. However, if you take a look at the mapping that New York State has, 7th grade maps to Algebra 1, 8th grade maps to geometry. Not exact, but the foundational skills that are in middle school, seventh and eighth grade map to either algebra or geometry. So take a look at where those students were 2 years ago. We were coming out of a pandemic. Some of them that were in Algebra 2 that were struggling actually may have taken Algebra 1 during the hybrid year or a fully virtual year. So those foundational skills that happen here at the middle school, like Ms. Licato said, a lot of the foundation and a lot of the numbers that we get at the high school that we show off do start here. So that was kind of, and you don't immediately see it. It's going to take 2 to 3 years before you're seeing it in a Regents exam. So there is some lag in especially for math. And the math is cumulative. So if you're missing those foundation years, And that's where I want to speak about the Algebra 2 piece. Those students in seventh and eighth grade were definitely cut short due to either us closing for a pandemic or hybrid and fully virtual years thereafter. And then coming out of that, if you remember the following years, they didn't give every Regents exam and students had an option whether to take the exam. So there were a lot of things around the exam, and math is difficult. And It's a snapshot of one day also. So to answer some of those other questions you had before, I think you started with Mr. Kassane asking the question. So maybe they walk in that day to take that one snapshot of that exam versus all year long and improving and meeting with the teacher and going to extra help and doing some, whether it be an extra credit project or something. So that's how their grades keep afloat. And then you take that one snapshot of that one day, and maybe they had a bad day. Maybe they were sick. I remember the year that we had students that had to call out sick because they were testing positive for COVID. So things like that were happening. So now it's just kind of, now it's coming out to our numbers and what they're looking like now.
Can I ask you which ones, and I mean, I'm sure they're all on there, but somebody had said to me, and I could be wrong, that it was Algebra 2, that students that master it well seem to do better on the SAT. Is that true? Or I mean, I'm not saying, but it's,
That was on our reel. So yes, they do.
That was also why, because some parents have said to me that they needed their kids to get tutoring for Algebra 2, more so because they needed it for future SAT scores or something.
Well, the SAT does encompass algebra, geometry, and algebra 2. So it's all three.
I want to just jump back with geometry, because when I look at these numbers and the trends from pre-COVID to now, while the in the mastery level, 85-100, they went down, as we can see, they're 6%. But the actual final course, they stayed relatively same in like the 40, about 40% of the students mastered it, 40, 48. And it through over those years, that kind of stayed while the number of students that mastered it went down. So is there an explanation for why, even though they're doing well in the course, these students, the same percentage of students over these years are doing well, but the percentage of students that are mastering it, the exam has gone down.
Again, it could be that snapshot of that one day walking into the Regents. You have one and done. Whereas those other grades I think you're referring to are their final averages. So that's over an entire year, and things are taught in, I'm going to teach you this, we're going to have a test on this. I'm going to teach you this, we're going to have a test on this. At the end of the year, it's cumulative. And it's a large, every single day. I mean, you can ask any student that every day in a math class, you're learning another topic and something new. So it moves fast. There's a lot chalked into 1 year of a math program, of a math class. Okay. I have to move this. Okay, so some of our AP results. We are slightly below in our calculus, AB, BC, and statistics. However, we've also seen a drop in some of those, the enrollment in some of those classes. And again, attributed to maybe students aren't going towards that class. We have seen an increase in the AP statistics class. So we have 6 sections of that this year. And students are also, that's a dual enrolled course. So they have the option whether to take the AP exam to take to purchase the Suffolk Community College credits up to 6, or some do both. So that we have seen an uptick in that. AP Computer Science A and AP Computer Science Principles, those numbers speak for themselves. The AP Computer Science Principles is an entry-level AP course that ninth graders who have completed algebra in eighth grade can take. So that's a catch-all class. You might find a ninth grader all the way through a 12th grader taking that course. I personally think it should be every student kind of taking that if they are going into the workforce and or college. So that's a great catch-all course.
Can I just ask for you to differentiate the two calculuses, please? The BC and the AB?
So the easiest way to look at it is the calculus AB is 2 college semesters. The calculus BC is 3 college semesters. So like if you know, calc 1, 2, 3 in college would be the BC. When the students sit for the BC exam, they also get a subscore in AB. So those students do receive 2 scores, although they're only sitting for 1 test. Correct. You're welcome. And finally, as I just spoke about our dual enrollment courses, we have a new one coming out for next year through Farmingdale University, up to 4 credits in pre-calculus as well as pre-calculus honors. So students can enroll in that. However, there is one caveat that the students have to score a 70 or above in the Algebra 2 Regents the year before, and that is set by Farmingdale State University. And that is a piece that my Algebra 2 teachers are speaking with students now because they're in the registration point. And if they are, you can take the course. However, it's purchasing the credits and earning those credits through Farmingdale. Hopefully that will change in the future, but that will be for 24-25 school year. And to answer the question that you had asked before about the esports, I checked while I was sitting here. We have 57 requests so far for the course. So I'm hoping that a lot more will roll in. Our computer science and experience, 6 through 12. Actually, it is a K through 12 experience. Unfortunately, we didn't get to do the elementary presentation yet, so I'm kind of backwards with that. But we do have, starting in the fall of 2024, computer science and digital fluency standards, K through 12 from the state. We are in full implementation mode, so we do have a program at the elementary that we will speak to at our next board meeting presentation. However, starting with sixth grade, and Mr. Licato had mentioned this is part of that experience for sixth graders, is the digital literacy course. Again, pulling off of those mandated standards. In grades 7 and 8, we have a push-in program. We have 2 teachers that push into the math classes for students throughout the entire year, and they are using our Codoyo platform, and they are learning block coding. They're learning Hatch, which is Scratch, programming language. And at the high school, we have 2 highlights. We have the CompTIA, which is the A-plus certification. Thank you for supporting that, Board of Education. We have 4 students thus far we're in our third year, and we have 4 students who have earned the full certificate. So in order to earn the full certificate, you have to take both CompTIA 1 and CompTIA 2 and sit for both exams. So that is a wonderful experience there. And we have more students interested in that because it is something that they can take into the workforce directly with that certification. And our IT department was very excited when we said we were bringing that to ConnectQuad. So they've been a great support as well to that program. On February 5th, our high school computer science students are going to participate in a hackathon. So that's always fun. I'll let you know how that works out for us. And we also have, as Ms. Burns mentioned earlier, with her new exams starting, we have this year on June 4th, we're going to have the first administration of the Algebra 1 Next Generation Learning Standards Regents exam. And then each year thereafter, they're going to implement in the early June time. We don't have the time frame yet. Geometry the following year. And then after that would be Algebra 2. So the exams are changing ever so slightly. However, they are changing the titles just slightly. And we are moving away from the Common Core standards into the next generation learning standards.
Does anybody have any questions?
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
It's tough with math. Thank you so much.
Okay. Good evening. Thanks so much. I'm very proud of our music and art programs here throughout the district and all the opportunities our students get. Just to highlight some of that, our middle school students receive art in their sixth and eighth grade years. They explore working with different various media to create traditional 2D and 3D projects. At the high school level, they explore the same traditional 2D methods and as well as media mixed into that. At the high school, we're offering those 2D, 3D classes, digital art, ceramics, sculpting, comic book and illustration, drawing, painting, photography, and film for our media. We also offer our AP Art History class and Advanced Art Portfolio, which gets students prepared for beyond high school and preparing their portfolio in different projects and of the sorts. Next year, officially, we'll be having our peer mentoring art. Right now, it's kind of an unofficial practice run slash opportunity for some of our students who work with our life skills students at the high school. Mr. Majeski currently teaches that, and our life school students who take art with him have students coming in and helping out and mentoring with the life skills students. So next year it's going to be offered as an extra elective for those students who want to get that opportunity to not only work with the students in art, but just get that chance to help mentor and work one-on-one with our life skills students. And also our broadcast journalism class is in its second year, and we'll discuss that a little bit more as we get to our English electives later. We do have some dual enrollment opportunities coming up next year, provided through Five Towns College, we're excited about, through our advanced digital art, advanced photography, and filmmaking classes. So those students who pursue that and push it will be able to get those credit opportunities for college afterwards. Students, as you know, have their art displayed throughout their buildings. They have it displayed locally at the Conecuh Public Library. They have the rotating schedule. You get to see it central office all the time. But in addition to all of that, we have our Showcase of the Arts, which is our largest event that we showcase all of our students' work. We have some of the projects, and it's one of the projects I have up here is our collaboration project, a monster project with our first grade, some of our first grade students and our advanced classes at the high school. First graders will come up with a monster character. They'll create it and they'll get sent up, and then the high school students will interpret it and put their version of it, and then we put it together and go side by side. So it's actually on our webpage too. If you look, has all the projects there. You can see all the elementary work and how it works with the high school students. So it's a great opportunity for our elementary students to send their work up to the high school, and then the advanced artists can then do their rendering of what they see in the picture and then get it back to the students. It's really a beautiful collaboration. And same thing we do with our ceramic students too. The kindergarten, some of our kindergarten classes will send up a monster in two-dimensional form drawing. They'll send it up, and then our advanced sculpting students will make a three-dimensional object, shape the monster as their interpretation, paint it, and then the reaction of those students getting to see it the first time at the Showcase of the Arts, it's all displayed, and they come out and, oh my gosh, look at this, and they get to take it home with them. It's beautiful. It's great. So it's really wonderful for our students throughout to be able to work together in collaboration. We also have some of our students who participate in BAFA, the Bay Area Friends of the Fine Arts exhibits, our Heckscher Long Island's best young artists. We had one of our students, you'll see in another photo, who was his work was put in there last year at the Heckscher Museum in Huntington. We have a film festival in Locust Valley our film students participate in, and the BASH Awards, which is the Broadcast Awards for Senior High, which is our first year last year that our broadcast journalism class got to go to. We have our secondary honors art show, which honors our high school students in May. And of course, like I said, our Showcase of the Arts. And there's a picture of last year's student at the BAFA Gallery. Oh, there's the other one. And there's the Showcase of the Arts. We also have some of our students, like I said, that's Parker in the top right corner, who's work was featured in Heckscher last year. Some of our advanced digital art students get to go to Dan Weldon's studio. Dan Weldon is a world-renowned artist, printmaker, solar plating, and he works with the students one-on-one in his studio. We get to go out and visit in Sag Harbor, and they get an opportunity to work with a world-renowned artist and take home their pieces, which are hanging up outside the showcases at the high school. Next time you're up there, you can check it out. And our ceramic students get to go to Nassau Community College to do a Raku project with them. They get to work and fire up their clay outside. And it's a method that they use, and they get the opportunity to do it there with Nassau Community College for that piece. There we go. And in addition to that, you know, we have trips where we go to the city for Museum Modern Art. We visit the Arboretum for photos and inspiration to take to these places. And those students get opportunities to really showcase their art pieces and get inspiration from local and surrounding areas. For music, very proud to say that we are, again, a community, a best community for music education presented by the NAMM Foundation. It's something that we are, that they look at as far as programs that are available, what students do, what the opportunities they do, their community involvement. And it's something that we're very proud of, that say that we are a member of that. And hopefully, again, this year, we'll be adding the 2024 to that list. At the high school, middle school and high school level, students get their music opportunities through ensembles and performances. Students who are not in an ensemble in the middle school will get general music in their sixth and seventh grade years. And at the high school level, same thing. Students will get their music credit through their ensemble playing and some other offerings. We have three levels of music theory with our AP Music Theory 2 students who can take that. We have our mindfulness and music class, which this is the first year we're doing it. This is the first half of the class, and it was an opportunity for those students to explore music and how it connects to the human experience, and using music to help focus, how to meditate, how to reflect and practice mindfulness. So the second half of the year, starting next Monday, that class will also turn into mindfulness and mentorship. And the life skills students will be taking that class for the second half of the year and for their music credit. And they'll be working with the students one-on-one to get an opportunity to do the same thing with that. So it's an amazing opportunity for all of our students. And Mrs. White teaches that at the high school. It's a beautiful course. I'm really excited. A lot of students are very, very, very happy they took it this year and looking forward to see how that program grows. We also have the opportunity to offer dance for next year, which is the first time that we've ever been able to do this, which we're very excited about. Yes, thank you, thank you, thank you. One of the things, even I, like I said in the past, where I've noticed as a director of the musicals and being involved with the shows all the time, you see so many students come out who you don't see in the program every day, but really love to dance or have that opportunity to dance. So being able to offer that to them is really a tremendous opportunity. I'm hoping to see that grow and flourish, and thank you for your support to make that happen. And we'll go from there. We have also some dual enrollment opportunities for our music students through Five Towns College for some of our ensembles and music theory classes. We're excited about that for next year to do that. Just some pictures of those opportunities that the students get to do. Obviously, our concerts, which is, you know, we have our winter, our spring concerts, our select ensembles. We have our jazz concerts, which a plug for this Friday. We have our middle school and high school jazz concert, which is also going to be collaborating with the Tri-M to sponsor and benefit our John Michael Lasher Scholarship. And it's going to be a beautiful concert this Friday night, starting at 6 at the high school. But it's a chance for those select groups to perform. I know we honored some of our students back in October who were going to Allstate, and this is a picture of them performing up in Rochester this past December, which is a beautiful opportunity for them. Our Tri-M students, we are fortunate to have Tri-M at the high school and both middle school chapters. So getting the students involved in community and service, it's beautiful. And our musical productions, that was pictures from last year's show. Ron Conkman here had a beautiful production, looking forward to Newsies next weekend. And the high school has Mamma Mia coming up in March. So we're excited about that.
Incredible, love all the plays. You guys are doing a fabulous job.
Thank you.
Beauty and the Beast was amazing. Can't wait to see Newsies. And I got to tell you, this was amazing seeing the Radio City Music Hall. I didn't get to go, but I saw videos from friends. Yes. And incredible that you know, I've been to the Philadelphia Holiday Parade. Yes. To cheer you guys on.
Mm-hmm.
Incredible. Doing all this is really seeing how much you've done over the years and made it even more so. Thank you.
Thank you for the support.
You are doing the mentorship. That's amazing. And can't wait to see the dance program.
Thank you. Yes, likewise.
So just to piggyback off, I think the music and arts program is amazing. I love that we're bringing in the dance program. I love all the extras that we do. I'm going to give you a challenge. Do you think that we can have like a dance competition team, like a club ish, if you will, like we have a cheer team and they go to compete. Do you think that perhaps the music program could bring in like a dance team to go compete?
Absolutely, yes. Something we could definitely look into. I know currently right now we have our kick line team that works with the marching band. And, you know, when we do our fall season, they are currently doing some smaller local competitions right now and competing in that sense. But yes, I understand the difference of a dance team that, you know, throughout different districts on Long Island. Absolutely, it's something we can look into.
That would be so fun. Thank you.
Of course. And like you said, we get these opportunities where we can go explore and share our talents and with other areas, but also get to see other things and other places and other venues that do this. And like you said, the Radio City Music Hall is a great opportunity. Our Oakdale Middle School got to go to the Met Opera this year. Ron Conklin just came back from Lincoln Center last week to go see a rehearsal there. We travel, you know, all over the place, all over the country, the world with different festivals of music, music in the park. So a lot of these opportunities our students get just from being able to be involved and part of the program and really embodying that love for creativity through art and music. And like Mr. Mallory said earlier, you know, it's really important to have that mental capacity and fitness to be available to do this. I get to walk into a classroom and see these students shine, you know, who are having a rough day. And I walk in, I see a student working on a project and they're just in their culture, in their home, and they're just comfortable. And being able to give these students these opportunities every day, it's really amazing to see them being able to do what they love, be creative, and just express themselves in every way possible. And we're very fortunate for what we have here. And we couldn't do that without your support, absolutely with our community support. And I thank you for all that. And we look forward to many more opportunities for our students this year. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Let's bring it home with English Language Arts and Library. So as you can see up on the screen, we have one Regents exam for ELA. We have a passing rate of 99% with a mastery rate of 77%. 75% of our students score a level 5, whereas the county is only 49%. So that's something to really be proud of. Looking at our AP courses in ELA, we have three courses that progress from 10th grade, 11th, and 12th grade. In 10th grade, we have AP seminar with the 87% of 3 or higher. In 11th grade, our students have the opportunity. Most students are in 11th grade for 69% is the 3 or higher. And for English Lit and Composition, we have a 98% of 3 or higher. So if you compare that to New York State, for a seminar, we're 10% higher than the state. For English Lang and Composition, we are 15% higher than the state. And for English Lit, we're over 20% higher than the rest of the state. So that's pretty remarkable. Moving on to looking at our libraries, it's very exciting. We have finished all the renovations of our 10 libraries in the district. They've been upgraded to library media centers. They're state of the art. They're really amazing. I know you've been to all the ribbon cuttings. And in those libraries, we have 3D printers in every library. The librarians are working really hard to incorporate that into their curriculum. I've seen amazing things this year. And this year at our library literacy celebration, we're going to have Gordon Corman, who's a very famous author. We are currently selling all of those books for our students, and he'll be there to sign them. And we will feature a bunch of activities for all of our students. There will be crafts for K-2, and then for 3-12, we'll focus on the author visit. And everybody will get a chance to take something home from the 3D printers that night. So we're very excited about that opportunity. And finally, we have a lot of English electives that we offer. Mr. Malafronte will come up with me in just a moment. But one thing that we brought this year is our children's literature course. And those students wrote their own books. And recently I got to visit with them to Sycamore Elementary School, where they went and read their books to our second grade students. And the second graders read their stories to them. It was such a heartwarming experience to see that happen. So I look forward to continuing that. Ms. Longo is doing a wonderful job with that course. And finally, to end off the night, Mr. Malafronte and I collaborate with our broadcast journalism course. They recently released season 2, episode 4. And what's really exciting is they have Thunder Bites, which are much shorter, timely segments that they're releasing about current things that are happening in our schools.
Yeah. And also just to, you know, to add to that, you know, last year, well, a couple years ago, we got to go visit Hop Hog and got inspired by looking at what they had to offer. I know last year's first year was really a learning curve for everybody involved, teachers and students, and to see the growth, you know, it was immediately from that next month how their episodes progressed into the, you know, beginning few episodes were a few minutes long to now our newest episode is 17 and a half minutes long. So it's something where they're doing a lot, getting out in the halls and interviewing teachers, interviewing students, reporting on certain things that are happening throughout the year and the building. It's really a great accomplishment. This little trailer here we put here is what they did for this year. After last year's visit to the Bash Awards, everybody got kind of motivated to, oh, this is what they are looking for in this type of, you know, program. So they came up with their own intro this year for the trailer, which will be something they're going to submit for the Bash Awards this year. And, you know, moving forward, we'll see how they do with that. So if you could play on that, please. I think the volume's down. So they do a wonderful, wonderful job there. And all the episodes are on that channel. If you follow ThunderVision, the link is also on the Fine Arts and Music web page. You scroll down to the bottom. There's a link there to see all their episodes up to that point. So thank you very much.
You guys did an incredible job getting that up and running like this when we went to Hop Hog. You really did an incredible job. And the teacher's doing an amazing job. He's excellent.
We were robust, but we were not succinct. And I hope that everyone enjoyed this comprehensive overview of our secondary curriculum. I'm just going to close by saying that we are perpetually growth-oriented, and that goes along with the work that we're doing to remain aligned to and driven by our standards. We always seek to expand opportunities for students, to enhance our programming, to embrace the shifts and to personalize the shifts to ConnectWatt. That's key. I think in every slide that you saw and every presentation that you heard this evening, and none of that occurs without this continual sense of collaboration and teamwork. And I think that's what I'm most proud of here. And so, again, I'm sure that additional questions will come forward from this presentation. Please don't hesitate to ask, and we're looking forward to revisiting with some of the directors our elementary program at the next Board of Education meeting.
So I want to thank the principals and directors for putting a lot of work into this with Ms. Poppy. Thank you as well. Absolutely. You know, I've said it a couple times that, you know, the learning, the academics, this is the bread and butter of a school district. And a night like tonight, a lot of time invested in the prep, a lot of time tonight for all of us. But it's an opportunity to celebrate all of the great accomplishments. But it's also an opportunity to reflect, identify areas that we want to target. We want to put action plans in place. This is what organizations of excellence do. They celebrate the great accomplishments all throughout the rank and file, and they also are able to take honest, reflective looks of areas, but where can we do better, and let's have at it. And the sense that I have from our administrative team is we're very happy with our accomplishments, but we're not satisfied, and we're ready to have at it in any area that we need further growth. And I thank all of you, and of course the support of this board for all the work that you've been doing, and of course our teachers and our support staff.
Thank you. Thank you so much for your time, for your explanations, for your presentation. It was very informative. Much appreciated. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you very much. It was great, guys. And sorry you had to stay up so late.
Really appreciate it. And I know there's some questions. I happen to love statistics. But the work that you all do is incredible. It showed tonight in what you did, and your dedication to what you do. It shows, and we appreciate it tremendously. So thank you, really. Thank you so much for everything that you do for us and putting this together for us tonight.
Thank you for being here. It's a long night. Thank you, guys.
Moving on. Ms. Craig, thank you for your patience. You are up.
First of all, thank you to all the teachers and the admin. We clearly couldn't do it without you guys. So I'll make this short and sweet. Student government will be participating in PS I Love You Day, and we'll be selling limited t-shirts for $15 and bracelets for $2. Any proceeds that are raised will go towards suicide awareness and the foundation that is helping us with the PS I Love You Day. Student government will be selling the flowers for Valentine's Day for 2-for-1 or 5-for-3. Student government will be pairing with ABC and sponsoring Valentine's Day flowers and bears being sold. We are all very excited about that. And overall, future teachers of America, students against destructive decisions, and student government will be sponsoring the PS I Love You Day to help suicide prevention. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Superintendent update, Dr. Centimore.
Thank you very much. I too will try to be robust and succinct. Thank you, Mr. Hauser, for the budget presentation. I also want to thank our board members for their attendance at various advocacy workshops. I mentioned earlier, obviously with the state aid, but that time commitment to some of these activities, which are late evenings and weekend activities, is greatly appreciated, and it's important for the public to know the work that goes in. Mr. Hauser, can you give a kind of a brief update? There's been some inquiries about opportunities for schools to have free breakfast and lunch, and what we're looking at and we're trying to do here in Connectivut.
Sure. So our district is part of the National School Lunch Program, which also includes breakfast, and that's part of the U.S. Department of Agriculture. Back in the fall, the USDA lowered the threshold from 40% down to 25% for either individual school buildings, groups of school buildings, or districts as a whole to apply for what's called the community eligibility provision, which if a school building, a group of school buildings, or if a district is approved, depending upon how the application is submitted, the students in each of those buildings will receive a free breakfast and a free lunch every day. So we submitted the applications, and 9 out of our 10 schools were approved. So we are working on the details of being able to provide students in all 10 school buildings with the ability to have a free breakfast and a free lunch each day. And that could start as soon as February 1st, if we can iron out all the details.
Thank you, Mr. Hauser.
You're welcome.
There was a really nice story that Newsday was covering. I believe it's at least online. Maybe it'll be in print tomorrow. Regarding a first grade student at Sycamore, Joey Penna, in Mr. Steinle's class. Young person had a great idea, which led to donating books to students. This led to a readathon that the entire first grade was able to contribute. Several thousand dollars was raised, used to purchase backpacks and school supplies for incoming Connectivut students who may be in need. A really great story. We're very proud And we thank Newsday and Snell, PR department, for contacting Newsday for covering it. Please, please check that out. Great story, source of pride here in Connectquot. High school recently had their curriculum fair, very well attended, and it was so nice to see the number of staff and students who were participating, to explain what's available for our, incoming ninth grade students. Ronk Middle School had their Beauty and the Beast performance. It was incredible. Can't wait for our Newsies, which is, right around the corner. And as Mr. Malafronte said, high school will be doing Mamma Mia premiere. Can't wait. Very excited. By the way, I recently went into New York City and I saw Back to the Future for those of you who are 80s buffs. It was incredible. Gotta love the arts. Big proponent, and nobody does it better than Connectquot. Future Teachers of America's Club, I had the opportunity to see them in action. They're visiting our elementary schools. And again, another opportunity for our older students to serve as mentors and peers, to younger students, really going over lessons on kindness and healthy decision-making. Kudos to them, outstanding. Mr. Malafronte talked about the jazz concert on, coming up on Friday. And a nice opportunity to raise funds for the John Michael Lasher Memorial Scholarship. Looking forward to that. I know Mr. Mallory can't wait for a future board meeting to talk about the accolades with our winter athletics. Tremendous, boys swimming. We had one of our students holds, Tristan Weingarten holds 10 school records, Newsday Athlete of the Week. Boys track league champs, wrestling 2021, dual meet runner-up. All of our teams highly competitive. I know Mr. Mallory will give a full rundown when he has the opportunity to wrap up the season. Very excited. Over at the high school, they have their local scholarship informational meeting coming up on the 25th. It was mentioned earlier about the FAFSA College Night. We're really giving this a big push. I know I have board members that want to piggyback this as well in terms of the January 30th night when the attorney's office is coming in on the dangers of fentanyl drug use. I'll let my board members, speak more about that. PTA, they, like all of our organizations, community organizations, do a lot of work. We're trying to give them a big push as well with the upcoming Harlem Wizards event. And kudos to our staff across the district. We have over 40 staff members from all of our schools, board members as well, who are participating in this activity. The Wizards are really great sports. I had one Wizard player today work with me to do a video promo. Please look for that. Hopefully that'll come out in the coming days. We're very excited for that district-wide event. We have a Literacy and Mathematics Elementary Night coming up over at John Pearl. A nice opportunity for our parents there. And I think that was a robust and succinct superintendent's update.
Thank you so much. And now on to board discussions. We have Beauty and the Beast, Jackie DiLorenzo, Jackie Napolitano, and myself. We're going to speak on that. I'll let you guys start.
Thank you. We went to see Beauty and the Beast, and I just have to say, as we can see, everything that Mr. Malafonte showed us, the music department is incredible, our arts department. And that show was amazing. These kids are so young. And what a job they did. It was really something from, the kids, the stage crew, the work they put into it. It is phenomenal. The singing was wonderful. Whoever played Belcher had such a pretty voice. It was really, it was a wonderful show. And I'm really looking forward to Newsies and Mamma Mia. And again, Mr. Malafonte, thank you so much because our music program, our arts is absolutely fantastic. As an alumni, that's my memory here, is the music and the arts. I loved it then, and I love it now. So thank you so much, and thank you to the students. You all did an amazing job.
I have to agree with you. Seeing they never disappoint going to these plays over the years. I feel every year I say it, and every year I say, oh, this is the best one I've ever seen. And then they top it the following year. It's this year, honest to God, it sounded like these kids were on Broadway. What was going on stage? It was magnificent. I'm glad that I was able to make it. Thank you for having us. And again, great job by all of the students, by all of the advisors. They really do an incredible job working with the kids. Stage crew, They're out there. They're working hard. Really exceptional job. Cast, crew, and the teachers.
What they said. It is truly one of my most rewarding things that I get to do is to go see the plays. They are amazing. The children are amazing. The staff that puts it together, choreography that goes into it, the background, it leaves me in awe every time. And like Jackie said, just when I think it can't get better, it gets better the next year. So kudos to everybody in the Arts and Music Department. Beauty and the Beast was amazing. I can't wait for Newsies and Mamma Mia. It'll be amazing. Thank you. Doors, Jackie Napolitano, Inferno.
Hey, we continue to stress how important locked doors are in the correct closed position in our schools for safety and security for all. I can't stress it enough. So I would appreciate, and really let's all continue to help foster safe and secure learning environments by making sure our doors in all of our schools are locked and in the closed position correctly. Thank you.
I will piggyback that. I have echoed that those sentiments to our staff. And it's, you know, the statistics don't lie, that locked doors will, provide maximum safety for our children and our staff. And so absolutely, our doors need to be locked and properly closed and secured.
Absolutely. They should be locked now before anything happens. And then the door should have been locked, as said. Doors locked, for sure. Board discussions, Jackie DiLorenzo.
We recently had a little bit of discussion about a policy that we have about exactly what we're doing now, board discussions, our opportunity to speak, bring forward concerns we may have or the wonderful things about our community that we see as trustees. This is part of what we do, and it was recently within us a suggestion to perhaps change a policy to limit us to 3 minutes apiece. And, you know, I had to look back again. I said I love statistics, and I had to look back at the discussions we've had since I've been on the board since July. We've had over 70 or so discussions. Over 40 of them were Jackie, 20 of them were me. So you could do the math. Most of the discussions typically from us. I'm not saying anything other than the fact that it seems that that limitation on board discussions, a change in our policy to set a precedent for future boards, is nothing more than just a way to ultimately silence us, to stop us from speaking. Even questioned about, you know, bringing up Veterans Day and the wonderful things that we talk about. I do not agree with that. And I think it's in the interest of transparency to let the community know that there was a suggestion to do that. And I do not think that's fair to future generations of board to change a policy, perhaps because they do not like us, what we bring up. And I wanted to just bring that forward and ask us once again, and I know one of the trustees had wasn't there at that time, but how do we each feel about that? Are we seriously considering changing that policy? Because I will absolutely be a no for it.
I'm not about silencing any board members. I understand that adding topics, and again, maybe it's because I've been on the board with people who had 20 years on the board, 9 years on the board, and I watched them over the years bring forward a lot of discussions. And a lot of my discussions and a lot of my questions are already things I asked the past 4 years. They're not things I've asked like doors. I've spoken about doors and locks years. But it's something that I feel like you need to touch on every now and then. And I don't think any one board member ever should try to silence another board member from putting anything on, because for years, Board of Education topics was never even in existence. A board member came to a meeting, walked on as many conversations or topics as they wanted, and from there, board had good discussions, and that's what's supposed to be done. It's through Robert's rules, it's open meetings law. These are not things that we should be putting in a silencer on. We shouldn't be trying to, and I disagree with coming up with any policy change. Because if we're going to talk about policy changes, last year people wanted policy changes and the board did not want to move on some of the policy changes. But we're going to move on trying to silence board members. I say if we're going to start changing policies, we better start looking back at some other policies and see about changing them.
Okay. I mean, I, for one, would not be for a time limit on us just because we never know, the discussion could go on for 5-10 minutes. So, but that's just my personal opinion. Dangers of fentanyl and drug use, featuring the Suffolk County District Attorney's Office, Jackie Napolitano.
The Connect-Quad Drug and Alcohol Task Force, which myself and April sit on, is having a presentation, The Dangers of Fentanyl and Drug Use, The Persistent Dangers of Drug Use, and the Latest Trends Witnessed Locally of Illicit Drug Use, featuring the Suffolk County District Attorney's Office. It's January 30th at the Connect-Quad High School Auditorium. All are welcome, 7 to 8 p.m. There'll be a game night and paint night for children grades K to 5. There will be child care offered by high school student volunteers. Thank you to those volunteers. Our younger T-Birds will be involved in a variety of fun activities. Like I said, it would be wonderful to see a big turnout. A lot of people went out of their way to start this task force. I know that Mr. Modica, Mr. Sidman, a lot of people in the high school have really worked hard to bring us all together to work and come up with ideas. Again, you are welcome to be there. It is January 30th, 2024, 7 to 8 p.m. I am sure that the Suffolk County District Attorney's Office is going to do a fabulous job. I am sure that there is going to be a lot of other people there. I was told that there are going to be different organizations that are going to be there as well. So again, looks like it's going to be a great night. January 30th, 7 to 8 p.m. I hope I see you all there.
I just want to add that also they discussed how it's not just for ConnectWatt. If people in ConnectWatt have friends who you think can benefit from this, anyone is welcome at the January 30th event. We want to help, you know, the entire community if we can, and communities that, go further. So just please know that you are not it's not just ConnectWatt. You can bring your friends, parents can bring their friends. It's for everyone.
That's a great point. Thank you, April. Transparency in emails, Jackie Napolitano-Ferno.
We just had an issue where board members are answering parents. They're answering and leaving off the two Jackies. So, and then the parent actually sent the email to me. So it would be nice. We can't just continue to talk about trusting board members and trusting one another. If I can't trust that if an email is going to go out and you're going to sign your name to a board email, you should not just have three board members on it. Because having only three board members, really got to reread those Roberts rules and really got to reread open meetings law. Three board members on an email speaking about board business is an illegal meeting. Five board members who have transparency to the email can be viewed differently. An email should not go to parents without all five board members knowing. And if you're going to send it on your own or speak to them privately, you have every right to do that if you choose to, as a community member, as a parent, however you want to word it. But not through CCS DLI emails, and certainly not leaving two board members out intentionally, because this is in high school. Let's try to be professional when it comes to emails. Let's try to follow Robert's rules, and let's really try to follow open meetings.
I think a part of that situation was an email sent to the Board of Education inbox, which I was against from the beginning. And this is one of the things that I was concerned about, having the information sent to trustees that and something like this happening. And it did happen, and both of us were left off. So I urge us all to please just keep everything that Jackie was saying, keep that in mind.
I think, to be fair, I think that was an oversight on the trustees' part, and we've since spoken, and it will not happen again.
Thank you. You're welcome. Advocacy, Jackie Napolitano-Ferno.
So I wanted to share notes I took. I thought they were valuable for community members to hear. I'm going to add it with enrollment and funding because it's all going to tie in together, advocacy, enrollment and funding, so this will be the end of it. So Suffolk County, since 2013, 2014, has lost 26,932 students as a whole, 11% of our students on in Suffolk County. 56 districts lost enrollment as a decline. 13 districts increased enrollment. ConnectQuad has had a decline in 900 to 1,000 students enrolled in the last 10 years. There were 3 years of record numbered increases in aid to schools during COVID. Now the cuts in aid, we can't make up in aid with the 2% tax cap through local funding. We need to advocate strongly as a board against these governor state bills that support cutting school aid. Last year, the fights with the state were over policies, not necessarily numbers. This year, the governor's proposed plans will cause schools to have to lobby and advocate strongly for funding to keep our schools moving in the right direction. It is critical to work with our elected officials to advocate for funding. While people do not want to hear politics in the budget process, it's unfortunate that that's where we're at. Foundation funding was barely an issue until last year. It was decided during budget process with the state. We need to fight for every last dollar for our district. This is our time for us to all be labor negotiators and fight for public education funding as a whole. We need to advocate to maximize state funding, especially this year. 45% of schools on Long Island are suffering true cuts. I need to find out, and this, Mr. Hauser, could be for next meeting, how have we reallocated and invested the money due to the decline in enrollment? How is this going to impact our district and community? I understand that over 10 years, it's been a slow decline, but when you're looking at it, it's still 900 to 1,000 students that we've lost over 10 years. Over that 10 years, we have not seen the staffing go down, though. Now, I'm not advocating for cuts, but I am saying, show me where we've reallocated and invested this money due to the decline of the enrollment, if you can, for next meeting. And also, how is this issue with the state funding going to impact our district and community as a whole? Because I don't want to see us cutting programs. I want to keep everything as robust programs and moving forward in the right direction. What can we do creatively? What can we advocate for? Because we may need to go to Albany as a board. We may need to get some of us up there and actually lobby for these governor's plans to not go through. We ConnectQuad is going to take a big hit with the foundation aid being now fully, the formula being fully funded the way that it is.
Thank you. Excuse me. My throat is so dry. Thank you. Can I call for a motion and a second to approve the second reading and adoption of the following policies? Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. I just wanted to ask, I know that at some point we have to, I thought we would have done this already in July, board goals that we would have set, because we do need to do that in order to evaluate the superintendent, which I believe happens in what, May? I think, July. July. So we need to, what are we doing with that? Because it was my understanding that we should have really gotten this going in July, as far as board goals and what we're going to do. I am new to this, so can somebody just...
So I think it's a great idea to do board goals. Most times board goals are done through retreats. I know that this board is not for a retreat, which is why I really haven't really brought it up for discussion, but I am open to a retreat where we can work on board goals. I don't know how the rest of the board feels.
You know what? I'm just going to say, just for the fact that, you know, many don't want to do the retreat, I think we should do board goals anyway. You know, we're waiting for Jesse, just so everybody knows, to get us back the, you know, the rubrics and things like that. And I think we are going to work on it, you know, no matter what. And I understand, like Marisol said, that, you know, not everybody's for a retreat. But it's not, doesn't mean that we're not going to do these things.
The retreat was a waste of money the last time we did it. 5 minutes after walking out of the retreat, a board member already texted me nonsense. Marisol, you already know this because I showed you. It wasn't Marisol, it was someone else. And it was absolutely ludicrous. So I personally will not vote yes ever to a board retreat that is going to waste taxpayer dollars, waste our time, because it's not going to make things better. Things only get better with people respecting one another's differences of opinions. And when you're an executive, the content there should stay there. And notoriously, ConnectBot, that doesn't happen. So, and that's not me just saying it, it's a known fact. So if you really want to talk about board goals should have been talked about in July. They should have. And we have a new super. We didn't discuss them last year because you had a super walking out the door. And you're not going to start. Board goals are not something that we're going to discuss tonight or this week or this month. And they're going to be done. That's not how it works. You first have to work on a mission statement. Then you work on a vision. And then that leads to board goals. It leads to the goals for the community and for the district as a whole. You want community input. You want a committee. That's why the T-Bird Committee last year was being put together to work on that. But most people don't realize this. I know you do because I had spoken to you, that a mission, vision, then board goals. I understand we're a very board that doesn't have a lot of experience. And I know nobody wants to listen to the board member who's actually been here the longest. But I still listen to the board members before me, asking them questions and saying, hey, it is good. It's valuable to speak to prior board members and say, hey, how did you guys do this? How did you make the last mission statement? It is good to also speak to other districts, which is what I do in an informal group I'm in with a bunch of other board members from other districts. And like they said, we have not changed our mission statement in years. We have not changed our vision in years. We should. We should look into it. We should work with a committee. We should. Doesn't have to be a retreat. It can be.
Actually, Ms. Kemp, I think, has some information on that.
Yeah, so I am looking into I'm gathering information for you guys to share with you because there are a couple different ways you can do it. I know that, some of this board has previously had a retreat that some people have, negative feelings towards. But, the reason why board goals are typically done at a retreat is because it gives you a separate time to discuss that. You know, it's almost 11 o'clock at night here. And, when we're having presentations, budget presentations, student recognitions, there's so much going on at a regular board meeting. That's why typically goals are discussed at more of a retreat or workshop type meeting. There's also ways to do goals where it's not necessarily all the mission, vision, and board goals. They're board goals. They're not community goals. So there are different. So I am.
Isn't it, though, done in public? I mean, I know what you're talking about. People use a retreat to kind of hide the board goal. But that's what they use a retreat because it's the way to get around open meetings law. In reality, if you're going to do board goals, you normally can spitball at a retreat. But the reality is when you're actually going to have discussions on board goals and whether mission, vision, goals in general, that's all public. I was told from prior board members who had experience with it that is done in public for the community to hear.
So board goal setting, yes, is a public discussion. Depending on who you invite into that time, if you decide to have an attorney sit with you, depending on what is discussed, it might not be the first meeting that happens. That's an appropriate public conversation. There could be things that are exempt from open meeting law. So again, it really, to answer your question, it's not black and white. It's not, it really depends.
And I just want the community to be given transparency on what our board goals are. Not that we are
The board also accepts them. The last time the board accepted and approved goals was in the 2016-2017 school year. So again, I am gathering all of that information and there is, and just kind of what other, just so you guys have like a nice place to look at it.
Can you look up how many years I've been asking about board goals? Because I know that it's at least three. I know I've asked Bob at least for 3 years the same exact questions that I asked last board meeting. Not that they're for him, they're the questions about the mission statement leading to the board goals, leading to the vision. They're the same questions I've asked since I got on the board. And every year I ask them, like clockwork, it's the same piece of paper I have.
Right, yeah. So again, I am gathering just, again, what other districts do, what not just locally, but just in New York State, the kind of, there are different options for you guys out there. And I just want you guys to have a comprehensive, it was requested like a couple of days ago. So I'm just working towards it.
Absolutely. No rush.
Thank you. Does anybody else have anything? Okay. Can I call for a motion and a second to approve? Yes, thank you. The second reading and adoption for the following policies. Policy 2382, broadcasting and taping of board meetings. Policy 4321, programs for students with disabilities. Policy 6710, purchasing authority. Motion.
Second.
Does anybody have any questions on any of the policies? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Does anybody have any questions on the consent agenda? Okay. Can I call for a motion and a second to approve the instructional and non-instructional personnel items as presented?
Motion.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Okay, can I have a motion and a second to approve items 2 through 12 of the consent agenda?
Motion.
Second.
Does anybody have any questions on any of the items? Okay, all in favor? Aye. Motion carries. I will now open the floor for the open public comment portion of the agenda. I will call individuals forward one at a time. Please wait for my acknowledgement before stepping up to the podium. You should have received a number card from security on your way in. If you have not, please see a security guard in the back of the room. Any person wishing to address the board shall address the board president only. Comments should be kept as brief as possible and relate to school matters only. Each person will be limited to 3 minutes for one or more topics. Individual employees, parents, or children should not be identified by name, title, position, grade, or building. The use of foul language and threatening comments will not be tolerated, and the board will consider a recess until order is restored. In accordance with policy 1230, public comment will not exceed 30 minutes. If there are additional persons wishing to speak, the board may consider a motion to extend the time. Person one.
Y'all made me read that for nothing.
Number two. Wherever you pick. There was no one.
Last year, the Progress Pride flag was ordered taken down. Many of our LGBTQ students came to most of the board meetings, and they expressed their fears, frustrations, anxiety, and depressions about school climate. Recently, the teachers' union sent a letter about mental health, expressing the teachers' concerns in the buildings about the mental health of our students. The letter also included statistics, dismal statistics, about suicide rates for LGBTQ kids and other minorities. The letter also stated and suggested ideas for funding our mental health concerns. Now, I, for one, want to just absolutely applaud the teachers for caring enough to take action to help our kids. Now, Based on this letter, some board members have stated that the teachers' union wanted to raise taxes and pierce the cap. That is absolutely untrue. I have here the letter, and I have the permission to read the union's letter, and I am going to just verbatim read the part about funding. As a district, we need to make sure that our legislators both at the federal and state levels who represent Kennequot, do more to fight for more funding for our school district. Two, as a district, we need to make sure that our legislators at both the federal and state levels do not cut funding to education and fight to allocate more funds towards mental health support. Congress is currently proposing cutting 80% of Title I funding. The 2% cap is a huge deterrent to being able to hire more support staff. Budgetary concerns. Excuse me. Perhaps discussion with our local legislators about some kind of funding outside of the tax cap used specifically for the mental health crisis that Kennequot and other local districts are facing. Not grants that go away, but real money that districts can count on every year. End of quote. Based on this letter, members of the board have wrongly stated the union wants to raise taxes. That is demonstrably false and needs to cease. Thank you.
Thank you.
I want to just give an update. So today in executive, we were very lucky to follow up with our leaders that have to do with all mental health. And I was so excited. I'm so excited to share that they are running a very robust and very well organized group of people, and they're going to work to make it even more effective and efficient than it already is. We have over 100 mental health professionals in our district with a decline of 1,000 students. We have the night shift is our teachers union, is all of our staff, actually, and I know I have it for my own job. It is the Cadillac of healthcare. And the wonderful program is the employee assistance. So there are a lot of benefits that we can take and that everybody should take advantage of and look into. And anyone who needs help should come forward and ask for it. And I can only speak for myself, but I would 100% support making sure that every student and every staff member is supported for mental health. But in doing so, we have enough staff, and we may be during budget season looking to add staff. But that's also not something that was written to the school. The school board was written emails that were not very professional in some ways, and really, I guess it's perception on what people think about the 2% tax cap. When people are saying we can't get things done under the 2% tax cap, we need to stay under that 2% tax cap, because we can't be putting more struggles and challenges on the backs of taxpayers. We need to work with what we have and do the best that we can, and also look for grants and look for funding, as we will continue to do. We are going to advocate, and the one thing I think that the whole board, and I can't speak for everyone, but I'm saying I think that we can all agree on, is that we want to advocate for more state aid to help with our education and mental health. And I think that we will all come together for that.
And I want to reiterate to a number that we heard, you know, at the last board meeting when we talk about piercing the cap, which stating that the 2% tax cap is a deterrent is saying we need to pierce it. So what we have to remember is that a number that was brought to us, which I was astounded by, is that our mental health staff, the salary is altogether is just under, what was it, 5 million, 4.9 million?
70% of our budget.
And them, it's, there is a, and as Jackie said, we have 100 people on that staff. There's a lot
right.
of people.
I think
and they are doing a phenomenal job with this. The people who are running our mental health.
Please, no shouting from the audience. I just think that the point they were trying to make is that the CTA president was not advocating for piercing the cap. I think he was saying that we need to advocate for more services so we don't pierce the cap, and because we might need more services that are over.
Marisol, I think that's a great idea, but I think that as a union president, he 100% should contact all the elected officials. He should 100% do that. That is something that would be brilliant, because that's what other union heads do across New York State. They advocate for those kinds of services. He has that kind of authority to speak on behalf of all of his members. And you see it all the time. They go to the other teachers' union, the one that's for the state. The same way that with, I'll use a police department. There's a police union, and then there's the big state union. And then there's the PCNY. And then there's the Nassau Conference and the Suffolk Conference. So you advocate with groups, and you advocate to your local officials. I appreciate that he wants us to, and I have no issue with advocating for funding. But I'm not going to take that from some of the emails that we've gotten that are hostile and horrible. I'm going to take that when our mental health professional directors tell us, and when they're telling us that everything is going, that things are working, they're our experts. They're the experts, not a union retired president.
I'm not arguing the fact. That was just clarifying the point that was trying to be made.
Right, but I think he should 100%. He should 100% advocate to those, the legislators. I would. I'm in a union. I 100% would.
And I'd like to finish what I was saying because I was interrupted. What I was trying to say is that the women who are in charge, they are doing a phenomenal job. They're working with it, and that is what he can do. He can absolutely do that, and instead he chooses to send emails which are rude, bullying people to do what he wants. I mean, he doesn't even come here to advocate to us in person. Instead, he sends these emails, and they're doing their job. They know what they're doing. They are the professionals. And when they come to us and they need something, we're not going to turn them down right away. We need to speak to them, but we're going to take their advice. They are the professionals in that field, and they are phenomenal. Thank you.
Not to mention, I have to just throw this last tidbit out there. It's bad enough that the emails have to name me about 50 times, which I'm entertained by now, but it's absolutely disgusting how many blatant lies are told in those emails. Blatant lies. And the sad part is, maybe you shouldn't speak for people in our district. This is going out to him, that you shouldn't speak for people in our district if what you're saying isn't truthful. And it's not, as we already have learned.
I just want to make sure there's not a number three, right? And no one else wants to speak. All right. Anybody? Can I have a motion and a second to adjourn the meeting?
Motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Have a good night, everyone.
Good night.